Barbados. Oh my gosh. Are we ready? Are we ready, Barbados? Listen, Barbados, let them know you're born ready. Let them know we are born ready. Good evening, Barbados. Good evening, Caribbean. Good evening, world. How is everybody doing? How are those in the diaspora in New York? Those in Philadelphia, and I think, is it Baltimore in Maryland there? Did you all feel that quick? How my Bajan people in Brooklyn doing? How we all doing? How is the Caribbean doing? The Caribbean people in Brooklyn? Listen, guys, listen. These are all reminders. Reminders to every one of us, our leaders, the citizens, everybody, that there's something greater than us. Someone greater, something, whatever you call, whatever you want to say, something greater. We are happy to be here. I know there was a big earthquake in the east there in the US, and the people said they felt it. So I'm just checking in on my diaspora friends to make sure that they're okay. Well, if this is your first time, you are watching the Marcia Week Show, and we are coming to you live from Barbados. And we have a great show lined up for you tonight. Tonight, we're going to be talking about Joe's River, still talking about getting that access or ancestral act, the access that we had, our foreparents had. That's the access we want for Joe's River. So we'll be talking about that this evening. And we also have Tricia Watson, who will be talking about everything energy. It's all about energy tonight. And she's been a real, real great advocate on this particular topic in Barbados. When I think of her, I think of, you know, like Harriet Tubman. That's who comes to mind when I see her, and her structure, and just how, you know, defiant she is. And that is Tricia Watson is going to come and talk to us about energy, and we're going to just keep it definitely, you know, keep it locked on Joe's River, because we have our big event on Sunday, which is the MOTORCADE, and we're going to get into that a bit more. But let me just welcome the people and say good night to everyone. Good night to everyone. And I really want to hear, especially from those who are watching in the diaspora in the U.S., to make sure that they are fine. I want to hear from you. It's great to be alive, guys. Great to be alive. Great to be in the land of the living. David has been on from 2:35. He's been logged on, and he says, blessings, family, outside or rather inside. Really looking forward to hearing Miss Watson. Yes. Barbados' greatest hero since Sir Wendell McLean. And I believe Wendell McLean is Maxine McLean's brother. I think I'm right. Am I not right on that one? Okay, Marvin Allen, good evening. Good evening. Falling in line. Opposition, fall in line. You ready? We're ready. We're ready, Barbados. We're ready. We're ready. We're ready. We're ready. Yes. Oh my God, Angel Humble, Nigel Carrington. Good evening, Nigel Carrington. Noel says, Miss Watson, the diaspora are ready to help fight the powers for destroying our beautiful Barbados. Please let us know what we can do to help put the pressure on those black sellouts and politicians. Oh Lordy, you know, well, you're calling it what you see. Cecilia Miller. And good evening. And I want to say the diaspora, I want to say to you, you know that you play a very important role. You know the role that you play, and you are very much part of the solution for Barbados. And you are part of the citizenry of Barbados. You're a citizen. I don't care how many countries you've lived in. I don't care how many, you know, you are a citizen of Barbados. That doesn't change. It's not going to change. Yeah. I don't care if the change in the paper, in your heart, you know, you're born here, your neighbor's string cut here. Yeah. All right. Loyal Daughter 66. Good evening. Good evening. Good to see you. Good evening, Loyal Opposition. She says, fall in line. Keep the pressure on. Do not let up. Keeping on. Fight to the end for Barbados. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And let me read one more thing from Loyal Dot. I love to read her comments. Stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home far across the river. Can you hear freedom calling? You see, that reminds me of Tubman. That reminds me of Harriet Tubman. And that's when I think of Tricia Watson. That's what I think of. Calling us to answer, gonna keep on keeping on. Yes, 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 yes. Y'all coming out to, you're coming, you're gonna be down there at Joe's River. Listen, don't be a social media warrior, you know. You're just typing away and then there's no action. I know that's not you. That's not my Bajan people. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Janita Calendar, good evening. Good evening. Raneem is saying like and share. Simone Daniel. Oh my goodness. Kali B. I have to call as many of you as possible tonight. You know, this is my family, y'all. Edward Tull, Marcia, Victorious Queen. Oh, welcome, welcome. Gelbiz. Hey, Gelbiz. Check your phone, Gelbiz. Check your phone. Peter King. And okay, Clive Osborne. Good night. Diana Husband. Some of you have such great comments and I can't get to read them because of time. Margaret Pollard. Ah, good evening. FX Trading, BB. Sir Alfred, how are you doing? You're in New York City or Lockton. Did you feel the quake this morning? And how is the family? Everybody's good? Rameem. Okay, I said Rameem already. Peter King. Ansel Seely. Erwin Nurse, good evening. Oh, my Lord. Guys, are we sharing? Are we sharing? Important to share. It's important to share. You know, let somebody else know that we're on and share the education. Yes? Jefferson Sobers, James Harding, ADG, Sanchez. Yes, yes, yes. Brian, good evening. Oh, my goodness. Judith and Clark, good evening. Business and Finance. I love that name. Business and Finance. Tony Paris. Sandra Carter. Yes, welcome, welcome, welcome. Yes, wonderful, 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 wonderful. Good to hear and see everybody. Oh, my goodness. Wayne Austin. Rosalind Carbin. Oh, that's our Auntie Rose. Ooh, and she speaks on education for us. And I have to send you something, Mrs. Corbin. I forgot about that. Llewellyn Eiffel, welcome. Junie Rock, welcome. Owen Ines, welcome. And I wish I could call everybody's name, and I can't because time is slipping away from me. But you know you're welcome. You know that we do this as a team. You know, we are here on this show, and you see myself, you see the panelists, but it is a whole set of people. I keep telling you, it's a 260-something thousand of us in Barbados. We make up the opposition. It's the people that I see in town and at the market, in the supermarket, at the hardware store, who come up and they shake my hand and they say, tell the panelists, tell Mr. Franklin, good evening. Tell Mr. Franklin that we are very, very happy for what he's doing. Say hi to Kimar. It's all of us. It's all of us. We are in this thing together and we are working together. It's your donations. It's your thank yous. It's your prayers. It's your good wishes. It's your joining and logging on every night. We are in this thing together, and it's together that we are going to Joe's River on Sunday, April the 7th at 2 o'clock, St. Elizabeth School, primary school. We are going to assemble there. We have our permit in hand. The permit is here. Collected it today. It's all here. Everything in order. You know, we like to do everything in order. I go and I collect this myself to make sure you are safe out there. Make sure that we have everything that we need. Paid for. This is the receipt, and that's your donation. I hope you can see it. I hope you can see it. Oh, you can't see it. Yeah. Hope you can see it. We paid $482.85, and this one is cheap this time. Normally the police is about $1,000. But then, you know what? You don't spend there. We spend it in the, you know, trying to help with the transportation, which I'm going to talk to you a bit more on. But I want you guys to let's stay focused. We are going down to Joe's River on Sunday, 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 and we are arriving at the Elizabeth Primary School on the grounds there at 2 o'clock. We assemble and then we move off, right, for a motorcade. Very, very important that we do that. Now, you're seeing this flyer on the screen, and I think we need to stop showing this particular flyer. But it has on it the Mighty Gabby, Ambassador Gabby, Anthony Carter. However, he's not going to be there with us because there's a close family member who's not well, and we got that message this evening. It's very, very unlikely that he's going to be with us, okay? So I'm going to we just need to use a different we'll use a different flyer because he is as far as what we are hearing, we doubt very much that he will be with us, and we don't want to do any false advertising. But you know, guys, you know, we've gone, it's 7:11, and guess what? We have not done our national anthem. Where's the national anthem? We didn't play our national anthem. That's our theme song. You know, that's our banner. That's what we, you know, when it comes on to lining up and doing what we have to do, that's the banner, is the anthem. Yeah. So let's stand at attention. If you're driving, you can't do that unless you park on the side of the road. But if you're home and you can get out of your bed and you can stand up out of respect, you know, I try to stand every night that this anthem is being played because I don't want to take it for granted. So I'm going to ask you to, even if you can't stand, but at least meditate on the anthem. Okay? All right. Of our faith. And that's what we are doing. We are crafting our faith. It's all about Barbados. We are crafting our faith. And we are not sitting idly by and waiting on anybody. We are crafting our fate. Folks, I tell you, that anthem is such a beautiful anthem. Very, very beautiful. Every line means something. Have you ever noticed that? Every single line, every time you listen to it, something jumps out at you, you know? And I know we did that exercise on this show before to, you know, just identify those lines that really, you know, mean something to us. And I know every time that we listen to it, it means something else to us. Now, how many of you are going to be at Joe's River? There are almost 600 of you already on here, and it's 7:15. How many of you are going to be at Joe's River? Let me see my badge on people. Let me see the hands going up. How many of you are going to be at Joe's River? Listen, Ramim says, I will. There's an I will. It's one person. One person will be, well, Ramim, I'll be there. So there are two of us that will be there. All right. But listen, we're not keyboard warriors, you know. That's the term I was looking for. They call these people who, you know, they watch stuff on social media, or they type and they share their opinions, and that's where it stops. We've never been about that. We've always been about being part of the solution. We've always been about putting in the hard work and sweating, you know, working. And that's why we have done so many marches. We've been part of so many marches in Barbados. And people say, oh, you keep marching. And so, yes, because we want what we're saying, the marches are very symbolic, you know. We're saying that, listen, we're not just about talking. We're about action. And that's what, oh, more persons are saying that they'll be there. This is Terry Carrington, Tyrone Blackman, Monica Hoyt. Oh, wow. Brian is going to be there. Diana Seeley, Sugarcane King, Ramim again, Cecilia. Listen, and bring out the family, you know, bring the children. It's vacation time. Bring the children. I think it's going to be very educational for them. And it's good to learn to stand up for their country, and it breeds patriotism. So bring the children out and let them be part of it, okay? Yes, Marlene, I'm looking forward to seeing everybody there. Tracy Barrow will be there. Now, guys, I want to, Scully Dog Kennels will be there. I wonder if that is my friend's Ras Simba. If he could just send me back the flyer, if he's here, if it's him, just send me the flyer in my WhatsApp about the event that you're planning in April, if that's you. All right. Now, folks, important, Ursuline. I have some notices here for us. If you desire to be in... Okay, one second. If you desire to be at the motorcade, and you are having trouble with transportation, now that has been worked out for you. There is a 47-seater van that is going to be at Freedom Park. That is the park. That is right opposite the Fairchild Street bus stand, the new park that is there, Freedom Park. There will be a bus there at 1 p.m. Okay, please don't let the bus leave you. Plan to be there. Cook early. Get, you know, get children ready. Do everything, the chores you have to do early. Get up early. Do your gardening. Take out the animals. Those of you who do those things, I go to the garden early. Do all the chores that you have to do early. Cook early so you can get there, all right? 1 o'clock, the bus leaves. If you desire to do that, it's important for you to send a WhatsApp. Send a WhatsApp message to 236-7000, okay? 236-7000. Send a WhatsApp message to us. so that we can, you know, book a space for you in the van. All right. Now, it is $600 for the trip. And that's it's both ways. So the van is going to pick you up at Freedom Park, take you to Bathsheba, and will also transport you in the motorcade. All right. So you're going to be transported in the motorcade in that same van. And that van is going to take you back to Freedom Park. And they will leave Bathsheba around 6 p.m. to take you back to Freedom Park. Okay. Now, what we're asking is for a donation. All right. And, you know, think about it. It's both ways. And let's donate something that is, you know, that could really cover the expenses. We're thinking if there are 47 persons in there and people give $15 or more, then we will be able to cover the expenses for the van. Okay. It's a 47-seater van. And so we are asking you, everybody, we pitch in and make it work, because you know we work off of donations, so we're going to need your help to make that happen. All right, the van stays, Angela, the van stays right with us in the motorcade, so you're in your van. Okay, it's your van, and it's going to take you right back to Freedom Park at 6 p.m. It leaves. All right. And so make sure at 6 p.m. you head for that van. All right. I can see messages coming in already. 236. The number is right there at the bottom of this flyer. You see the number there, 236-7000. Ask any questions you want to ask about the logistics. We can ask now. We have another 6 minutes to do so. Because Tricia Watson will be with us at 7:30 p.m. this evening. So this, we're just doing all the housekeeping. All right, all the admin stuff. We're trying to make sure we take care of that. All right. So and as I said, that we can do this together. Right, we can contribute and we do it together. We want to encourage you to wear softwear or comfortable shoes, because what's going to happen when we get to the last location for the motorcade, we are going to get out of our cars and park right along Bathsheba there. Okay. When we get out the car, then we're going to walk, and we're going to walk right into Joe's River. All right, so we're going to go right there. So we're going to ask you to wear comfortable shoes. I've been there before. It can be a little rocky, so you need to wear comfortable shoes. Though, yes, there's going to be food there, but we don't know. The problem with it is that we don't know how many persons are coming. So if you want to bring something extra, bring some snacks, you know, and anything extra to share, you probably want to bring a cooler with some drinks, soft drinks. Oh, my Lord, I'm teasing you all. Okay, bring a bowl. Bring a bowl for your soup. Do you have a calabash? Listen, I think I have 3 calabash at home here. You know calabash? Who remember calabash? I got 3 of them at home that I got the last time I was at Joe's River, actually. We did a big cookout there, and we had to clean out our calabash. Oh, my Lord, inside is so stink. We had to clean it out and wash it out, and that is what we ate out of. So bring your calabash, or bring a bowl, your spoon for the soup, right? And again, remember that the bus leaves Freedom Park for 1 p.m. and returns at 6 p.m. The cost, and so we're asking for a donation, at least, you know, $15. It was a big family. Obviously, I understand how it is, but just, let's just work together to make sure we can cover the bus. We'll have someone on the bus who collects the money and who will be able to pay the driver, and he will be happy and we will all be happy, right? Any questions? Okay, somebody said they booked their spot. They sent a message. Somebody said, I booked mine. We swear. Okay. Can you pick up the bus at St. Elizabeth? Okay. So when you get there, you can ask anybody you see in those shirts. We're gonna have on special shirts, and you can ask them if there's a space in the bus, because everything, there's so much uncertainty at the moment. We don't know how many persons are going to be on the bus. So you would have to ask a question at that time. Okay. Carpooling. That's another thing, guys. You know, St. Joseph in a car by yourself. You know, if you know other people who are traveling and we can carpool, that would be great. If when you get to, suppose you took the public transportation and you got to St. Elizabeth School, St. Elizabeth Primary, there will be cars there that you would be able, I'm sure somebody will allow you to go inside, you know, to drive with them. And we're not going to leave anybody standing there at St. Elizabeth Primary. We don't live so. All right. We're going to make sure that everybody is, that we are all well taken care of. We are a family. We are a family. All right. Those of you who pray, whatever you do, just pray that there are no accidents. Everything will be great. We'll have a wonderful day. Yeah. Make sure that it's great. Now, I want to tell you something that, what? Charles Atkins. I love you people. Good night, Marcia. Can you give me some good binge and directions? Tell me how many left and right turns and how many brown cows and dung trees do I have to pass? Listen, Charles, I would not be able to direct you. Wrong person. Wrong person. But I just want to say, remember, be comfortable, comfortable clothing, and come with a good spirit. The police will be there. The police is our friend, okay? We've been working with the police department, the police services, and they have been nothing but cordial and respectful to us, and we are going to do the same to them, all right? So we follow the directives of the police, and you know, because we want to make sure that we keep a very tight relationship with the police, all right? Very, very important that we do that, all right? Let me see if there are any other questions, and if not, I'm going to go ahead and get ready for Miss Tricia Watson. No other questions here. Somebody says here, we welcome Senator Watson. What a breath of fresh air since. Okay, all right. I can't read all of that, so that is good. But we welcome Mrs. Tricia Watson. Tricia Watson. Senator Tricia Watson is an experienced and highly trained attorney at law. She holds a Bachelor of Laws from the University of the West Indies in Barbados, the Legal Education Certificate from the Norman Manley School in Jamaica, a Master's of Business Administration from University of Durham in the United Kingdom, and other postgraduate certification. Tricia currently operates ELIN, Elin Law, a boutique legal practice operating in Barbados, specializing in utility regulation, law and policy, and corporate and commercial law. Besides private practice, she was a legal and regulatory advisor at Cable and Wireless Barbados Limited, and before that, corporate secretary at the Caribbean Broadcasting Corporation. Senator Watson was appointed to the Barbados Senate on the 13th of February, 2024. She is a leader of opposition business in the Senate. In recognition of her expertise, Tricia has been sought out by the Barbados government to be a leading advisor to the government on legal and regulatory reforms necessary to achieve actual liberalization and modernization of the electricity sector during negotiations between the Barbados government and the Barbados Light and Power. She served as a legal and regulatory expert on the special advisory team that advised the Honorable Prime Minister, Ms. Mia Mottley, on the national recovery after the 2019 island-wide power outage that seriously impacted Barbados' electricity and water supply for several days. In addition to practicing law, Tricia has actively utilized her training, talents, and time to contribute to the development of Barbados. She was an original member of the telecommunications working group that reformed and liberalized the telecommunications sector between 1999 and 2005. She was appointed as the first ever chairman of the Electric Light and Power Advisory Committee in 2015 by the Cabinet of Barbados. As chairman, Tricia was responsible for advising the Barbados government on energy policy and regulation in the inaugural stages of operationalizing the newly proclaimed Electric Light and Power Act and liberalizing and modernizing the electricity sector to facilitate wide participation in the sector by Barbadians and to ensure energy justice for all electricity users. Tricia has continued that work privately as an ardent energy justice advocate. As a leading electricity rate case intervener for over 2.5 years, Tricia has successfully represented Barbados' citizens, residents, and businesses in the recent rate increase applications to the Fair Trading Commission that were filed by the Barbados Light and Power in 2021, 2023, and 2024. Through her direct interventions with the FTC on the 2021 rate case, which she started even before formally applying to be an intervener, Tricia has realized $138 million in savings for electricity consumers in Barbados so far. She's continuing to represent consumers in the Barbados Light and Power's appeal that is currently before the High Court of Barbados. In recognition of her advocacy and activism, Tricia was recently named the Nation News Personality of the Year for 2023. Tricia's public advocacy doesn't stop there. Tricia has also commented publicly on constitutional issues. In 2021, together with Dr. Ronnie Yearwood, Professor Cynthia Barrow-Giles, Mr. Neil Marshall, Tricia helped to organize and hosted and participated in the Barbados Republic virtual town halls. The initiative filled the glaring public discourse. Filled the glaring public discourse gap in the lead up to Barbados becoming a republic and attracted hundreds of attendees as Barbadians desperately sought information and education on what it meant to become a republic. Subsequently, after the 2022 general election, she spoke out publicly against the necessity to change the Barbados constitution to lower the age for appointment to the Senate and to grant power to the Prime Minister to recommend appointees as opposition senators, and her statements were reported widely in the media. Tricia was a host of the popular Current Affairs radio calling program Down to Brass Tacks from 2014 to 2017. She hosted the most successful Nation Group Talkback live town hall meeting on the topic, The Barbados Economy, The Road Ahead, and has hosted the Public Education Forum on the Institute on Chartered Accountants of Barbados. And tonight, ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome to the Marcia Week Show, Tricia Watson. Good night, ma'am.
Good night. Are you hearing me okay?
Yes, hearing you loud and clear. It's a real pleasure to have you. And I know you sent me your bio, and I chose to read the entire bio because sometimes we read parts of it. I wanted to read the entire bio so that Barbados would understand the kind of work that Ms. Watson has been putting in on our behalf. And I truly want to say to you publicly, ma'am, thank you, because I know it is a sacrifice of love. It's a work of love that you do for Barbados. Welcome to the Marcia Week Show.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Marcia. And thank you first for the invitation. Thank you to your viewers who expressed a desire to have me give the presentation that I will tonight, which I hope they will find to be educational and informative. That's important. They need to be able to understand what's happening in our environment and, you know, understand where they fit in it, etc. So thanks very much for having me on with you.
Yes. Somebody saying welcome from Massachusetts, and they've been on from 2:30 something waiting, and yes, they've been on waiting and they're welcoming you. Welcome you. They say you look lovely. And
thank you. I recognize this person, a longtime friend. Yeah.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. And I'm trusting that the PowerPoint will be up. I saw it earlier, so I know that it should be there. But I will just allow you to start with your presentation. And yes, ma'am. So go right ahead. Right.
Okay, here we go. I think I can see it coming up. So right. Yeah. So where I'm going to start tonight. First, to just give my rule of engagement, and my primary rule of engagement is that it's all based on the facts. So I'm going to show the viewers some information about the rate, so numbers, and it's based on information provided by the company. You know, the company, Barbados Light and Power, likes to suggest that I am being misleading, but I take my information from their filings, from pronouncements of the Fair Trading Commission, so their decisions, information that's otherwise publicly available. And also, obviously, I've been doing this for a while. So using my own knowledge garnered over a long time doing work in this arena. And that is both in relation to the rate cases and anything that might come up tonight about the sector generally. So that's my primary rule of engagement. And then secondly, I just want your viewers and yourself to understand that we've done some calculations that are, and by we, I mean my team, that are very conservative. And so we tend towards making sure that those calculations are conservative so that it doesn't appear as though we are inflating any numbers to try to, you know, to try to exaggerate and be dramatic. We look at the data that we have and we try to be as conservative as possible when we do the calculations and presenting our arguments, making a presentation like this, participating in any other forum. So those are my two rules of engagement for tonight, as far as my own functioning is concerned. So the first slide that we're looking at here, it just simply says Minister Cattle, and I'm relying on some statements that she made when she was still a backbencher. So that's before she was reappointed to the cabinet. And in listening, that was the debate on the change to the Utilities Regulation Act in December. And you may be aware that I also engaged in some advocacy in relation to that because I was concerned about the government's move to give very wide discretion to the minister to grant exemptions to any licensee, a renewable energy licensee, from the application of the Fair Trading Commission Act. So not having to go to the Fair Trading Commission, in particular in relation to rates and any of the other things that they have jurisdiction over in the RE sector. And Ms. Cattle making her comments, reflecting on the issue, because you would recall they said they needed to have this power so that they could do some things in relation to storage. And they had made a mention of price gaps. And reflecting on price gaps, this is what Ms. Cattle had to say, and we found it to be quite attractive. So next slide, please. Can we have the next slide? Right, and let's proceed with the playback of that slide. You remember there's a video embedded in this particular slide. Now that doesn't seem to be coming up, or is taking a little time. But what the now minister said at the time was that their costs are supposed to come down. Oh, well, here we go. You should be able to hear her. All right. In the meantime, I'm going to fill that space because we're not getting the video. We're not getting the audio. The minister at the time said that when you're looking at a kind of a price gap or competitive procurement mechanism for storage, the intention is to drive down the cost of the transition or drive down the cost of the technologies. That's the language that she used. And that what was necessary is for the government to find a pathway for those costs, for the cost to consumers to also come down, because driving down the cost to the producers and the cost of storage or technologies, as she said, doesn't necessarily automatically mean that there would be reduction in prices to consumers. And so that was necessary, that a pathway needs to be found. And the implication, of course, being that we don't have a pathway at present. And my own observation is that prices have been steadily increasing, or electricity prices. And so hopefully we will be able to see that video. Yes. Are we having a challenge there?
Yes, they are. We had some technical, I'm sorry about that, some technical issues. And so they are trying to sort that out. Okay. Yeah. So the video is coming up. Yeah.
Okay. Because it's okay. I can see.
Okay.
Okay. So you've gone to the next slide because I think
we want to go back to the slide with the, with the video. Thank you.
Yes. All right, I think if that is proving to be a challenge, we can still, the basic premise is that costs, whatever mechanism the government is utilizing to acquire storage in particular, that is intended to reduce the cost of production. And there has to be a way, a pathway is the language that Minister Cattle used, to reduce the price to consumers. So I think that is essentially what we've been contending. We've been contending that the affordability is a true issue that we have to be looking at here. So not just for the government to transition to RE, but that when that transition happens, we, the consumers, should benefit from that transition and that our electricity prices should be affordable. And so I'm going to skip that slide if it's proving to be difficult, and we can move on to the next one. So that's the one that says electricity costs.
So we're having they're having some challenges with the bandwidth, it seems, every time it's dropping in, dropping out. So we're just trying to get it sorted out. I suggest we might have to, as you said, move on to the next slide because it played very well we were testing. Yes. So we just, in the meantime, guys, please share, continue to like, and we're seeking to just get the technical side up and running again. Yes, so just hang on there. Hang on. Anybody start taking notes yet?
Mark, if I can jump in here and just make a comment. There's been... What I've realized recently is people are starting to liberally throw around the word affordable and affordability, starting with Barbados Light and Power, even as they keep coming and asking for increased rates. And now the politicians or the government politicians are throwing around the word affordability as though it's sufficient to just say affordable or affordability. But we feeling it in our pocket, we know that we're not achieving affordability, not as far as what we're paying directly to the company, and we're not achieving affordability when it comes to the inflationary impacts of the constantly increasing prices of electricity. So of course, when you go into whatever business, we tend to say supermarket, yes, you know, because the supermarkets use what they like to call cold storage, as though they just go and buy some cold air. That's an electricity cost, and their electricity costs have gone up. And while a lot of them have utilized their roofs, they've utilized their roofs as investments, not necessarily to say, I'm going to push my cost down and pass that saving on to my customer. So, yes, you know, achieving, trying to benefit from the high feed-in tariffs, because they are high, there's a high return. They have said, well, I'm going to invest in this, and that's additional income for the company. So we are not seeing the benefits of RE energy production in reduced pricing to the Barbadian consumer, whether when you go pay your bill to BLPC or when you go and shop or buy goods or services in Barbados. But let's look at the next slide. So this slide, please go back to electricity cost breakdown. And what this does is just shows how the components of your electricity rate. So right now, we all know of the FCA, that's the fuel clause adjustment. And the fuel clause adjustment has been used to allow the company to pass through directly costs that they incur in producing electricity that are volatile, outside of their control. And fuel obviously is that, because we're importing that fuel cost. And so quite a long time ago, the Public Utilities Board at the time put this in place, and other utilities have used it in other jurisdictions, so that the company doesn't suffer because of volatility in prices in that market. And so we've had that for quite a while. But in the meantime, we have added to the fuel clause adjustment the power purchase from renewable energy production. So that's part of the FCA now. And we have added battery storage. And at the moment, we have in there the storage device that Light and Power put into place to support its RE, its renewable energy farm in St. Lucie. That's collected through the fuel clause adjustment. And they're now trying to collect for another $600 million dollars in energy storage devices through not the fuel clause adjustment, but they will ask for another mechanism for collecting that. And then of course we have the Barbados Light and Power production costs. So fuel, fossil fuel, purchase power, the other costs of BLMP for providing the service, and at the moment, recovery of the costs of the battery storage device in St. Lucie. Okay, so we can move to the next slide now. I think it's important for people to understand that, because there is still a presumption that we're only looking at the fuel, fossil fuel, that we import in that fuel clause adjustment. So we look here now at the prices, the actual prices now that go to make up what we're paying. So we have a 10-year average. We've had to deal with averages because we don't want to just take a date and say, this is what your fuel cost is, et cetera. And so we have 99 cents on average over the last 10 years. And we know that fuel prices have fluctuated. They've been up and down. And this also includes the cost. How can I put it? Whatever inflationary costs we've experienced because of the Ukraine war, that's in there. So we bring that right up to 2024. But we've had that fluctuation. And so we have smooth that and given you an average fuel clause adjustment price. And prior to the interim rate, the costs that we paid directly to Light and Power outside of, so the non-fuel rate was 21 cents and per kilowatt hour. And we also have the purchase renewable energy. Now that is feed-in tariffs. We had started with the rider prices, and now we have the feed-in tariffs. And on average, again, that's 40 cents per kilowatt hour. And we've put in here what we anticipate the CETR price increase will be. So that's 14 cents per kilowatt hour. We take that number from the actual application that is before the FTC. So let's look at the next slide. All right, so we're going to, I'm going to show you some numbers where we will see what our electricity cost was before we really started to add a lot of RE to the grid. And we're going to compare that to the prices that we're dealing with now. We're having to pay now that we have a higher amount of renewable energy produced on the grid that is a direct pass through to us. So we're looking at, we do three scenarios, low fuel clause adjustment, average, and we saw that price before, 29 cents, and a high. And that high is based on the highest that we've seen it during that 10-year period. So we want to show you some comparative numbers. So let's look at the next slide. I hope people aren't finding this too dry, but this is important for you to see the numbers when we talk about affordability and whatnot. So we say, when we look, and I'm talking about my team, we look at these things together. And just so people understand, my team comprises not just me, but I also have engineering expertise, deep engineering expertise, deep accounting expertise, and economic advisors, economists who advise us as well, so that we are looking across the board at the pretty much what are the component elements of what the FTC will consider in making a decision. And so when we say 2018, 0% renewable energy, the amount of renewable energy on the grid that we were paying for at 2018 was statistically insignificant, 1.8% of the energy that was sold in Barbados. And so we've zeroed it out because it is that insignificant an amount that we were looking at the time compared to the amount that we know has been put on the grid and that we're paying for at the moment. So that when we look at the BLMP price, we know that that's 21 cents and we have not changed that. Fuel, we are taking the average. I'm going to ask you particularly to look at the average column. The average fuel price was 29 cents. Purchase power, we've kind of zeroed that out because it really wasn't significant. There was no CETR. And so the total price on average for your per kilowatt hour rate was 50 cents. And when we look then at the non-fuel charges, so we're not looking at the FCA charges, we know that the price is 21 cents for Barbados Light and Power. And we are saying that the non-fuel portion of the bill was 42% of the bill, and the fuel portion of the bill was 58%. And that's important because obviously if the fuel prices are high, then that affects has a significant impact on your bill. And we will see that there has been a shift because we're shifting away gradually from fossil fuels. And so you will see that there is a shift in that balance of what we pay as non-fuel amounts versus fuel amounts. So we can, I think, move on to the next slide. And I'm also looking at my own my own laptop so that I can keep up. And now we're going to look at what we estimate the cost with renewable energy will be. And we've been really conservative. We've looked at what we think is likely to be the amount of renewable energy sold to us on the grid by 2028. And what we are determining is that, notwithstanding what the government has said about 100% renewable energy, that is unlikely. Not on the trajectory that we're on at the moment. We're, based on what the company has said, there's 13% of renewable energy on the grid at the moment. And we know that there's a whole lot of work that has to be done. And so we've just said, let's say 50%. We even think that that's generous, but let's say we have 50% on the grid by 2028. Read then, again, same scenarios for the fuel clause adjustment. We're looking, keeping in mind that power purchase is in the fuel clause adjustment. Low, 20 cents, average 29, and high of 45%. So we can move on to the next slide. So when we look at the 2028 50% RE scenario, you see how the numbers change, what we are likely to be paying for electricity per kilowatt hour. And what we have here is that the BLPC price will go up, and that reflects what the price will be if their 2021 rate request is granted. We know that that's before the High Court, so that is still a possibility. At the moment, we're not there because what they had was their 50% interim rate increase. You know, my position on that is that that's unlawful. But if they got the full increase at their request, then that's the price that we'd be looking at. And that's non-fuel. Then when we look at fuel, you'll understand that there will be a shift. So we will move from 29 cents, and that will change because there will be more purchase power on the grid. And so obviously fuel will be displaced, more RE. And by then, should the FTC grant the current CETR request as their storage application, there are a few other components in there, but storage in the main. And if that is granted, that's another 14 cents per kilowatt hour. And so we will see that our price per kilowatt hour would increase on average to 73 cents per kilowatt hour. And we are comparing that to 50 cents per kilowatt hour when we were just primarily using fossil fuels. And so we see that there's a tremendous shift. I think nobody expects that. That's counterintuitive. We have an expectation that our rates will go down. We do not have an expectation that the rates will go up. And so that is the practical impact of the pricing, not the policy. The policy to shift to RE is a commendable policy, and nobody is disputing that. What we are concerned about is the transition and the fact that we have not found what Minister Cattle calls the pathway to reducing prices for consumers. And essentially, that's why my advocacy is necessary. And again, when we look at the non-fuel charges, we're seeing that on average, those non-fuel charges will be 59 cents. And so that's gone up as well. And if you're looking then at the allocation between non-fuel and fuel, then there's a shift. A higher amount of our money, the abbreviation KWH is kilowatt hours, that's the measurement for usage. You will see that on your bills. And that's how the rates are charged. So the Barbados State and Power is granted a particular rate, whatever it is here. We are saying, at present, 21 cents per kilowatt hour. That's their non-fuel amount. And then they will also charge an amount for fuel, oil used per kilowatt hour. When you look at your bill, you will see it articulated in that way. And so when we look at the non-fuel charges, we can see that there is an absolute shift between the amount of your bill that is attributable to fossil fuel and the amount that is attributable to renewable energy. The costs don't go away. We still have the costs of production, transmission, distribution, all of that, and of course the profit element of it. And when the FTC sets feed-in tariffs, the FTC says this is an and storage rates, the FTC says this is an acceptable return. So they've still taken somewhat of a cost of service approach to determining what a person should earn who's producing renewable energy. In fact, right now, the consultation, again, that I have said publicly more than once is unlawful. And I've written to the FTC to say this consultation for the company that will produce hydrogen, power from hydrogen, they've gone to the FTC to say, can we get a rate? And the rate of return, I believe they're asking for is 10.2%, something like that. And the FTC right now has a consultation. That consultation has ended because they said you should send in your comments on that consultation by 4 o'clock today. What I'm saying is that those people aren't licensed. They do not have a license. So how can you set rates for them? Wheel and come again. When they have obtained a license, or when, well, yes, they still have to get a license. They either can come then, or of course they can go to the minister and beg for blight and set rates as they please, because the minister now has that power as of December 2023. So you can see then how the rates are moving. These are really important practical things that we have to pay attention to, because people tend to say, oh my goodness, look how my bill has gone up, but we have so much RE and all of that, not realizing that those costs are passed directly to us in the same way as fuel is, and that the FTC sets those rates. And as long as those rates remain high, our rates will remain high. On that note, those rates are set for 20 years. Yes, indeed. 20 years. The FTC can review. But of course, if a person goes and gets their loan and they, you know, do all of their financing projections and whatnot based on what they expect is a 20-year rate, I think it would be difficult for the FTC to say, don't worry about that. We're going to reduce that rate. And they have not reduced the rate. What they have done is to introduce new rates at a particular point. So they will say, from this date, these rates will apply to new licensees, but the original licensees will continue to get whatever that 20-year rate was, you know, when it was granted. So we have to keep that in mind as well, because then that means that for 2 decades, 3, however long, at least 2 decades, we are going to have these prices that we have to contend with. Conceivably, for new RE systems, rates will go down, but not necessarily, because what we saw in the most recent feed-in tariff review and revision is that for big systems, the rate was increased, and increased significantly. And now we have a player who's saying that they will have a 300 megawatt system asking for a pretty high rate of return. And that is certainly higher than the rate of return that the FTC approved for the Barbados Light and Power in the recent rate case. So we have to pay attention to all of these moving parts. Next slide. Okay, so here we go now, looking at some of the myths that are out there. When the Barbados Light and Power puts in their application, they tend to put out some publicity. That's important. Anybody will do that. And of course, they also come and ask for us to pay for that publicity, but that's a whole other issue. So they will come and say, this is what the average increase will look like. And they make some assumptions. The assumptions, however, are not reflective of what is actually happening in the market. So they have, in our view, looking at the rate application applications that are before the FTC, they've miscalculated the average residential electricity consumption to give an impression that the impact will be minimal. Beside what people feel it in their pockets, but what they reflect on and make anecdotal comments about in relation to their bills. I think part of the problem there is that Barbadians tend to expect that their rate will be, what was it? The Barbados Light and Power had said on average $6 more for what they would pretty much describe as the average household. And they say the average household is 150 kilowatt per hour usage per month. That is not the average based on our review of all of the information. And if you look at your bill, I really should have told you to tell people to get their bill so that we can look at it together, but we can do that perhaps another time. You will see your usage, and the average usage is probably comports more with the threshold that the government has set for the reduced VAT amount, not mine. Unfortunately, my also usage is quite high. But if you have kids and they're in the fridge all the time, and you know, nowadays it's so hot, you either have to have a fan or you have to have on some AC. All of us actually probably have seen an increase in our usage. And when we analyze the household bill before the interim rate increase was generally on the order of $154 a month. Some people will be higher, some people will be lower. So that depends, obviously, on how many people are in your home, the average size of a home. And but generally, this is the amount that we think more represents an average household bill. So when you look at the next slide, we, again, doing the analysis and looking at the rate increase that was requested in 2021, so that's the first rate case that is now before the courts, plus if we add the CETR rate increase, so that's the storage, the battery storage increase that's before, request that's before the FTC at the moment, the average household bill will move from $154 per month to $234 per month. The FTC, the Light and Power itself, says that the average bill will increase to by $41 per month. And then when we add the other part of the rate increase requested in 2021 and look generally more at what we believe is the average usage for the average household, we're looking at a bill that increases significantly, $234 per month. Now, of course, anybody can come and dispute that and say, well, this is what my bill is likely to look like. But we're taking averages and we're being conservative. We're looking at the applications that are before the FTC at the moment and assuming that those increases are granted because they're all right now wide open. No final decisions have been made. The CETR application is still at a stage where data is being considered. I have asked there's a whole heap of interrogatories being data requests and questions to elicit evidence. I've asked the FTC through a formal motion to compel Barbados Light and Power to answer interrogatories that they have themselves deemed to be irrelevant. And that's not the FTC, that's the Barbados Light and Power saying this is irrelevant. I've asked for those questions to be answered and for the FTC to have an oral hearing, because this rate application currently before them, the battery storage, is a significant amount of money. It is the single largest application that has gone before the FTC, single largest application of the Barbados Light and Power. And that $800 million request is not a substitute for what we're currently paying. It is in addition to. And when we look at that application, we don't see any information about retirees. Maybe there will be some, but we don't have that information so that we can say, okay, the bill is going to reduce this way over here. We're doing those numbers ourselves, but we don't have that information from the Barbados Light and Power in terms of we're going to retire this fossil fuel generator and the second and the third. And keep in mind that the Barbados Light and Power has recently commissioned just 2 years ago, a new, they call it the Clean Energy Bridge. That's 33 megawatts using fossil fuel. And they intend to keep that for redundancy. That nobody's quarreling with that either. Our quarrel about that is how long a life should be ascribed to that, because that affects the rate as well. And so all that is in play. This all probably sounds so convoluted and so confusing, but all of this is going on at the same time that the government keeps talking about investment and keeps talking about how important it is that we get these rates now, and keeps talking about consultancies and studies and all that. But for us who have to find that money and pay that bill, this is what we are facing. And so this is our analysis in, because the CETR application is before the FTC at the moment, and that high court matter could be decided in Barbados Light and Power's favor. And if that happens, this is the kind of price we're looking at as the average householder. It could be less if a court says, no, you're not going to get this rate increase. Now, let me just rewind a little bit there to explain where we are with that rate case, the 2021. The FTC in February of last year pretty much dismissed that rate application. The way that it works, that the applicant, like Empower in this case, will say, look, here's our application. We have all of these schedules with the numbers in it, and maybe they will give you their cost of service study. So that is how they determine how they're going to attribute rates to each rate class. And they will also say, here's our sales projections. So the revenue we expect to get, here is our capital expansion plan. Some other data, but those are some of the key things. And the FTC said, we reject a lot of that information. You're not being transparent. Refile all of this. And so that's the compliance filing that we keep saying, but we should have that, and that the FTC has stoutly refused to order the Barbados Electric Power to serve our interveners. Well, now that's all in abeyance while the matter is before the High Court, because that's part of what they have appealed. And essentially that decision was, no, we're not granting you the rate. But in the meantime, we're going to keep the interim rate in place, notwithstanding that we have rejected the information that we kind of sort of based the interim rate on. Again, we need to understand these things. I see your reaction, Marcia. So the interim, when the FTC granted the interim rate, the FTC pretty much said, you know, we don't see you justifying this request, because when we look at the data, what you've given isn't lining up with your claim that you can't fund your operation. That's essentially what they said. But they said, we're going to give you an interim rate, 50% of what you've asked for as an increase, because the rate, because of regulatory lag, because the rate case could take a long time. And when they came back in February and they said, you know, the Lighting Power hasn't been transparent, we find some of this information not to be reliable, and so we are rejecting that information, go back and refile these schedules. They kept the interim rate in place. Now, if they didn't base it on the data that was before them in the first instance, and then they came back and said, you know what, it's true, we don't even accept that data, how do you keep it in place? That's a question that we keep asking, and that is a question for your viewers to contemplate. It shouldn't be in place. So that rate request was rejected. That's the practical impact of that decision. The Barbados Light and Power sought a review. The FCC said, no, we are not changing any aspect of that decision. And now we've all gone off to court. And well, not we all have. Some of the interveners have not participating in that appeal. But I am participating in that appeal. Office of Public Counsel and intervener went. And at present, we're waiting for a judge to be assigned to that matter. Now we have the CETR, that's the one that's before them now, and that's ongoing. You know, we're making demands for information as basic as, can we get the people's financials, can we see how much money they actually made in 2022 and in 2023, so that we will know, you know, if they actually need to come directly to consumers' pockets for this investment, etc., etc. And there's a third application, which is a request for a rate increase for them to rent generators for 12 months initially, because they say it could be beyond 12 months, but ostensibly for backup for the World Cup, and then for another, if World Cup is June, then another 10 months or something like that. And they're asking for that to be charged through the fuel clause adjustment. Yes, you heard me right. Again, if the parameters are, the price has to be volatile outside of your control, there's another parameter that the FTC tends to cite. What about renting some units, maybe in a, the last time they did it after the blackout, they just had some units in a container and they put those down and utilize those. So what about renting two units, which will be here on site? You're managing them. The only volatility will be the fuel that goes through it, which we're already paying for as a pass through. What about that is volatile? And why should you come to consumers to say, pay for what essentially is an operating, normal operating activity? Because right. You're saying, oh, it's true, we're going to back up. Why do you have to come to consumers to ask for that money through the fuel clause adjustment directly? that should simply be part of your normal operating and maintenance costs. And because it is not an element that will be recurring, that's the other thing, a recurring, it's not an element that will be recurring after the 12-month period, it should not go into your rate base either. And so that is the third application that we are dealing with the FTC right now. Let me just say something about that. That's the application where that application was filed at the end of January, I believe, or in February 2024. I filed an intervention application. And the way that it works is that you file and you can say, well, you know, I'm not able to file all of the elements of that application right now. And therefore, you get a 15-day business day window to file your supplementary letter of intervention, which I did. As you would know, my father had passed away before that. And all of what that meant was, or is, some of it was because we were looking at the funeral, but continues to apply. And I later asked the FTC for an extension on filing interrogatories, and they said no. They said no mere hours after Barbados Light and Power wrote and complained that they had given me an extension in the CETR application. And I then I sent in my interrogatories under the 15-day rule in any case. And they came back to me 2 days ago to say they have directed Barbados Light and Power not to answer those interrogatories because essentially I was out of time and in essence, I am at fault. And at the same time, just today, the Fair Trading Commission itself has issued additional interrogatories to Barbados Light and Power in that same application. They have gone back to them to say, answer some of the things we didn't answer before, plus we have some additional interrogatories. So at the same time that they're telling Light and Power don't bother to answer my interrogatories, they're sending additional interrogatories to the Barbados Light and Power. I raised that to demonstrate the unfairness procedurally that interveners have been contending with in all of these rare applications. We will continue to fight these matters. And I fundamentally believe, and the FTC itself in at least one previous decision has indicated that they do not think that the Light and Power should be coming to collect these kinds of costs through the fuel clause adjustment. That's the FTC's own decision based on the test for whether this is an appropriate recovery mechanism, volatility outside of your control, recurrent. And so we will continue to press the FTC on that particular application. If the Barbados Light and Power is granted that increase, that's an additional $3 and something cents. I wrote it down somewhere today, $3 and something cents per month that will go onto your bill in short order. All right? It will perhaps come off eventually, we don't know. But it should cease, presumably, after 12 months. But immediately, you will see that rate increase if they're granted. And they've said it is urgent, so we can look at the FTC granting a decision in that if they continue to ignore intervenors' requests within the next few weeks. So lay of the land, everybody will understand what we're dealing with. So let's look at the next slide. All right, so BLMP tells us that the rate increase in 2021 rate increase would be on average 11%. That is not true. The rate increase is 25%, and that 25% number is the Fair Trading Commission's number. That little picture you see there with the highlighted aspects, that is taken from the Fair Trading Commission's decision, and we will read it. As a result, the rate design proposed by BLPC, which anticipated an overall increase in base rate revenues of $46.4 million or 24.98% when excluding fuel expenses and proportionally larger increases to customer charges, is no longer appropriate. So that's their commentary on whether they thought that that increase was appropriate based on all the data before them. And of course, they had rejected a lot of that data. So they're saying it's not appropriate, but their own calculation says No, you're not asking for an 11% increase. You're asking for a 25% increase. Think about it. 25%. Anybody going into the supermarket, anything at all, your insurance, anything like that, and somebody came and said, we know we're going to raise this by 25%, you will balk at that. You'll be horrified. But that is essentially what the company has asked for. That $46.4 million is what we would call the revenue requirement. So that is the additional amount of income that they would be asking for based on the numbers that they present to the commission. What we say is no. When we do all of the arithmetic, all of the analysis, including using some of the numbers that the Fair Trading Commission changed in relation to specifically the return, cost of equity, and the rate of return, that number goes away almost completely. We whittle it down to just a couple million dollars. So you could never get that level of increase if you apply the FTC's decision. Let's look at the next slide. Again, the Barbados Light and Power presented data to the FTC based on what we call the test year. What the Barbados Light and Power, the mechanism requires that you say, look, this is a representative year. This year represents our normal operations. Barbados Light and Power chose 2020. You know what happened in 2020? COVID. Businesses were closed. We were all at home hanging out on our curtilage. And we know that the tourist industry, you know, just didn't function as normal, et cetera, et cetera. So the sales, the electricity sales was way down, and they will quote sales in gigawatt hours. So we have what their actual sales was, 889 gigawatt hours. And they said to the FTC, based on that, we should get this increase because, you know, our income is really way down. But one, that is certainly not a representative year for anybody in the history of mankind and electricity production and sales. That's the first thing that we need to note. Secondly, when we look at the actuals, and you can see the years here, when we look at the actual sales for 2023, and again, this is Barbados Light and Power information, we're not making this up. This was presented in the most recent application. The actual was 974 gigawatt hours. And our calculations show that that actually translates to over $22 million in extra earnings for the company annually. So contrary to their assertion that their earnings are down, their earnings actually went up. And keep in mind that, you know, they're also earning they've been earning the interim rate for the entirety of 2023. And you can see the forecast for 2024 and the forecast for 2025. Also, keep in mind that we are looking at ever increasing temperatures. And we know, you know, there's a point last year where you couldn't get somebody to install an AC unit, you couldn't get a fan in the stores, and that was electricity sales increasing. And then obviously for companies that are using AC, particularly cold storage, the temperatures will impact the production, the amount of energy that they utilize to keep their climate at the level, the control level that they need to ensure that there's not spoilage and that kind of thing. And so their sales went through the roof. Record sales for Barbados Light and Power last year. We anticipate that that will be higher. Not we, they anticipate that that will be much higher this year and even higher next year. How then can the company argue that it is not making sufficient money to fund its operations? Can we look at the next slide? Again, the Barbados Light and Power in its communications to the people of Barbados and to the FTC will tend to reflect on things, particularly things that we have been saying in the public. So we have this issue related to the steam plant. there's a tendency to try to minimize it, but that is a serious issue. When we consider the fact that the Barbados Light and Power in its 2009 application said, look, if we retire this steam plant and we are given rates that will allow us to attract investment so that we can replace the steam plant, it's going to save Barbadians $30 million per year. And at the time, they were basing it on a fuel cost that actually was far lower than what we experienced in fuel costs when the cost of fuel really peaked during those years between 2010 and 2021 when they submitted this application. When we do the analysis, and by we, I mean all of the interveners now, because we all looked at it and considered what the cost was to Barbados's economy, to Barbados ratepayers, by what the cost that we incurred by the Barbados Light and Power not retiring that plant, we found that they cost us an additional in the order of $800 million in fuel. That's money that we could have saved if they had put in the more efficient plant. When did they put in that efficient plant? That was commissioned in 2022. That's a couple of months before the actual rate hearing, and certainly during the rate case. And in addition to that, that steam plant featured large when we had that 2019 outage. The problem being the plant was not working, and therefore that affected their ability to recover and provide electricity after the initial outage. So that has a price. Nobody's ever given us that price, but the FTC itself in its own report on that outage said that steam plant not being available was part of the problem. So that's one. Two, the company had said that that plant was obsolete. The company depreciated that and wrote it, took it off the books. Zero was the value of that equipment. The company then went about spending money, 20 something million dollars, to put that equipment, they call it relifing, putting it back in service. $25 million that they sought to recover in that 2021 rate case as well, recover that money in a period of, I think it was 3 years, completely ridiculous. And at the same time, their own information says one of those steam plants, well, it's retired. They're using it for spares. So it's actually not used and useful, which is the language we use technically in determining whether you should be able to recover for a capital expenditure. And the other one, 10% operating capacity. So arguably that's not used and useful either. So they've spent that money on equipment that was obsolete in 2009 when they made that application. And so all of these were the things that are in the mix when we look at whether Light and Power has been operating efficiently, whether they have been operating prudently. And again, that's another technical consideration when we look at setting rates under this rate setting mechanism that we use. And we have to consider the cost to ratepayers and the cost to the country in the Light and Power failing to act prudently and efficiently. And we haven't even come to talk about the self-insurance fund that they took the money out of. And that is significantly problematic when we look at how the company has been operating and indeed how the company has been regulated. And let's look at the next slide. All right, so the new promise, as I call it, the new promise from the Barbados Light and Power, new compared to the promise that, you know, we'd get some efficiency and some savings if they retired the steam plant and put in the new medium speed diesels. The new promise in 2024 is that we will save money on fuel through the renewable energy put on the grid and through storage. Particularly though, they focus on storage. And so they say it will be a hedge against future oil prices and will save us money. Is that indeed true? Well, let's look at the numbers. So let's look at the next slide, please. When we look at our truth, what we are facing right now, based on all of the information that I've just shared with you, and if fuel prices remain at the average Ukraine war levels, so what we are facing as a fuel clause adjustment, fossil fuel that is, right now, we would save $890 million with that 10-year plan. So pretty much what they had said we would tend to save, and that the 10-year is, we're looking at the life of the storage device. And so over that 10 years that item, those devices will be used and useful and storing energy produced from RE, we say, okay, you know what? And by we, I mean the country, the government, Barbados Light and Power, we're going to save the country this amount of money because we're not buying fuel. But then when we look at what we would have to pay, taking all of the projections, all of the numbers, the rate requests into account, and that's only what's before us now, because the CETR application, I think they call that the current project, implying that there will be more. So you could get additional applications for recovery for storage. So when we look at what we would have to pay out as consumers, we are looking at $800 million during that period for purchase power from renewable energy. And we're looking at $1.4 billion in storage rates, CETR. Keep in mind that that's the storage, a total of $2.2 billion. That means we will not actually pay less. We will pay $1.3 billion more in rates. Being conservative and looking at all of the numbers that are before the regulator at the moment, looking at all of the rate increases, this is what we stand to pay in that period. And that's the reality. That's why I keep talking about affordability. This does not suggest affordability of electricity for Barbadians, and I will say generally Barbados, because obviously electricity, besides being, you know, a commodity that allows us to do what we're doing now, it is an input cost for production. And if we're saying we want to be competitive, even as service providers, because, you know, whoever, financial people who are doing international business, whoever are part of the service economy, our costs have gone up. And if we want to be competitive, we want to ensure that our costs remain at a level where the fees that we charge and the government's fees, user fees, because the government's bill has gone up as well, make no mistake about it. And the minister responsible for Minister of State has said that the cost of electricity to the government have gone up. And that's with the government having its own renewable energy installations. And so we're looking at the country paying, individual consumers paying significantly more for electricity at a time where we are saying share the bounty, share the benefits. I don't remember what the saying is, but we are looking at a very few set of people sharing the bounty, because that's money that will be earned. That's the other thing. That's not cost, that's earnings for whoever are the producers and the Barbados Light and Power, and that money coming out of the pocket of consumers. And so that's something that we have to definitely pay attention to. It is not something to gloss over. It is not something for people to say, people are just intervening because they want attention. That's what they said about me all of the time. And that, you know, you're just giving trouble and blah, blah, you want attention, that kind of thing. And yes, and you as well. And so that's the narrative. And at the same time, we have quite a lot of money being earned and quite a lot of money that will be charged to consumers, businesses. There's a point at which, no, what we say in electricity, and we did it in telecoms as well, you look at your pricing and you say, look, how elastic is this price? How much can the consumer bear? And we know that consumers will pay certain bills. They're going to pay their electricity bill. they're going to pay their water bill. And on water, electricity cost is the highest cost component for producing water. So if those costs are going up, you can bet your bottom dollar that water costs will be going up. Similarly, the telcos have been putting up, telecommunications companies have been putting up their rates and saying, well, you know, inflation, all that's electricity costs. And so obviously more, but a lot of it is electricity costs in Barbados. So that we know that consumers will pay the electricity bill, they will pay water bill. If they got to go to the doctor, they will go for essential visits, non-essential things they might put off. I'm told by the people who provide cosmetology services that the women will still go and get their hair done and their nails and that kind of thing. But so those prices, regardless of where they go, the women will still go and do their thing. But people will then forego other expenditures. They will say, you know what, I can't afford to buy whatever, my favorite brand of coffee or whatever it is, that might be an extra something, or maybe send a bouquet of flowers to somebody, that kind of thing. And they will say, we see it in the legal profession, where when costs are high, people say, you know what, I'm not going to bother to get that divorce, or, you know, be a whole train and live together and see how we can manage. But that's the reality. So people will say, I'm not going to spend this money over here because I have to have electricity in my house. And particularly now where we're communicating using this mechanism, those bills will be paid and the company will know it because they do the elasticity studies. And so the businesses will find that they're affected as well. In particular, small businesses, because they don't have the cushion. And what one of my economists says is that, for example, one sector that is very, very much affected by those electricity costs is the agricultural sector, because we're thinking that, you know, as a fellow, they're doing some hoeing and digging and whatnot, but they're mechanized. And so they have those costs as well. Chicken production, yeah. You know, there's the lighting and all of that. You have to control your environment for production. And so they're affected by those costs. And we will see the increases in the cost of commodities and services to us. And so there is a, for me, to be honest, there's a little dishonesty in the way the private sector addresses this issue, because they seem to think that they can pass the cost on. But is it harsh to say dishonesty? Whatever. The point is, there's a point at which they will not be able to pass on the cost. So they too will be affected. And that's the point, really. I'm not trying to rag on them. What I'm trying to say is that businesses will also be affected. In particular, small businesses, self-employed people will be affected by these costs, these rising electricity prices. And so we can see how the entire economy will be affected and what will be the benefit to us. We've seen what we will save versus what we will pay. Carbon neutrality, maybe you get some carbon points. I'd have to see that analysis, but when I look around to see the kind of data that is produced internationally, we're not significant carbon producers. And so is it worth the cost of the economy? I think the answer would have to be no. And what else can we get? Bragging rights, maybe, to say that we've done it. Well, let's look at who we're bragging to. The countries that we're bragging to are not doing this. There are some small island states that have done it, but they did it because they were underserved. And so it was the most sensible thing to do, to build out their grid and to provide power. But we're not there. Yeah. And so the answer isn't actually don't do it. The answer is don't do it in the way that we are doing it.
That's right.
Well, smooth, you know, that transition, you know, and allow, and also look at how you are dealing with the pricing. That has to be a specific policy objective. No, we are not trying to have the most expensive electricity price or to even keep it where it is. We are looking to have affordable electricity so that Barbadians can produce, can have, you know, a good quality of life, and can have the niceties, and also so that Barbadians can benefit from their investment. Because the other thing you will find is that small producers are not really getting gains because their electricity prices have gone up. So a lot of them are still paying electricity bills. So when we say, oh, create wealth, that's not happening for the small producers. Right. And if you know, they would tell you that. And so we reject the criticism that we are trying to stymie or slow. We are trying to slow down. We're not trying to stymie. And we appreciate the environmental benefits. We appreciate the desire to green our economy, but it has to be affordable for Barbadians. And there has to be space for wider economic participation, wealth creation, not save a little money, actual wealth creation for Barbadians generally.
Yes, wow.
You can give me a question.
I mean,
the time will allow.
Very deep, very insightful presentation. I do have some questions, and I'm hoping that, and I see, I can tell that Caswell has some questions, and Ms. McLean is on. She's struggling with some technical issues as well. She's on, but she has some questions as well, and of course, our viewers. Let me just say to both Ms. Watson and the viewers that the video that we had a challenge playing, that we are going to be able to play that later on in the program. There was just some issue with playing that video. We don't know why, but it's resolved now, and we are going to be able to play it later. So apologies again for that. But there was a question that came in since last, 2 nights ago. And the question is, it says, I'm just going to read it just as it came in. The document presented from Light and Power was 450 pages. Some pages were blocked, and they want to know, were these documents reprinted? Are you familiar with that, Ms.
Watson? Oh, I'm very familiar with it. I'm the person that raised it in the first place. So
okay.
In the 2021 application, Barbados Light and Power's application was about 1,300 pages, 1,300 pages. And of those 1,300 pages, about 425 were blacked out. And by black, I'm going to show you my phone. Oh, lost. You can see my children's pictures. But it was black. If I had a black sheet of paper, I'd show you. And
okay.
Yes, so completely black. Not a single bit of writing on that paper. If I show you this now, where they come up, they keep coming up. So they're not letting me show you. As soon as I move the phone, you can see their pictures. I have to apologize because I say to them, no, you will not be on social media. I don't put your pictures on social media. But when you looked at those pages look like this, right? You're going to see my reflection, but they were completely black. And that was impossible. The Light and Power claimed that was confidential information. Now, the way the confidentiality works, they can claim confidentiality, an applicant can. In fact, if I submitted something as evidence in a rate case as an intervener, which I could say this is confidential. What they deemed to be confidential, they were saying, you know, we have to do all of this because we're going to have new licenses in the new licensing regime. They blacked out all of those. And they blacked out their expansion plan, their capital expansion plan. So the plan on which they based their argument that they're going to make investments. And they had blacked out some other things. I can't remember off the top of my head, but 400 and something pages. And the FTC eventually said, well, we're going to have a confidentiality hearing. And what I had to say to the FTC is, look, it is impossible for the entire page to be confidential. No margins, no spaces between words. And that's not the way that confidentiality requests can work. You can redact the actual confidential information, but you can't come and say the entire page is confidential. And eventually, like Empower said, oh, yeah, we're going to change our confidentiality request. They gave us some of the information, and then when the FTC at my prompting said no, but you can't just do that by a letter, you have to refile the application with the unredacted information, Light and Power withdrew its confidentiality. Sorry, they withdrew the non-confidentiality and said we're remaking it confidential, and the FTC played along with all of that. There's a certain ridiculousness about how the process has been managed. And that's part of our problem. So when we hear oh, it takes too long, it takes 2 years. The PM is quite right. That rate case should not have taken 2 years. It would take a long time. Thank you. It would take a long time because it is complex. You cannot file a 1,300-page application and ask for significant increases in rates, and it just takes a couple of months. So it would take a while. But the FTC allowed Lightning Power to not answer a single interrogatory for 6 months. And then after it said, okay, fine, answer some interrogatories, Lightning Power, as has become its custom, said that's not relevant to several pertinent interrogatories, which meant that you then had to deal with that information during the oral hearing. And even then, they refused to answer questions directly. And the FTC eventually, in their decision, said that they found that they were not transparent. And because, you know, we were having that challenge with them answering. So you had that kind of situation where a lot of the timelines could have been truncated if there was a more rigorous management of the process, I'd put it that way.
Thank you so much, Senator Watson. There's a question here that says, my question to Senator Tricia Watson, when the time comes, is it not better if Barbados gets its own energy plan, seeing that it is already costing us millions to someone else's pocket, I guess pouring in millions into someone else's pocket?
You mean if we should have a separate grid or a separate grid operator?
Yes, they said, is it not better if Barbados gets its own energy plant? I'm not sure what they mean by that.
So I'm going to take a guess. I'm going to assume they think that we should have our own energy company that we've liberalized. No problem with that. So we will have multiple producers, well, at present, that's what it looks like. We understand that the national energy policy is being reviewed. Therefore, all of what we're saying here could, in a couple of weeks when that is produced, you know, not be relevant. On that note, I want to say this. The government says they're going to put new legislation to govern the sector before the parliament. They keep saying shortly. They've said that for a long time. I don't know. And they've been saying that since 2019. So that could mean in the next 6 years at this rate. But my question is, how can you have a new law drafted when you are reviewing the national policy at the same time? That doesn't make any sense. On what policy are you basing that legislation?
Right.
And so you have to watch that and see what comes about there. For me, it's nonsensical. You'd have to complete that review, consult on it, because we've all seen how things have been rolled out thus far. And it is necessary for when you say stakeholders, that is not just the investors and private sector entities and consultants from elsewhere. Barbados's consumers have to be part of any consultation process because we're the ones that will pay for it. We can't complain about that. That's the way that it works. But the how and the amount is really the issue, and that's something that has not been confronted. And so I do not think that our electricity company that will operate the grid should be owned 100% by any foreign entity, and that's the case that we're facing today. If you were talking about energy security and resilience, so that if anything happens, you have to be able to recover, we should not be at the mercy of a single shareholder who is offshore. And we have heard representatives of that shareholder threaten this country. We heard it during the rate case, and we keep hearing, oh, if we don't get the rates, you know, you're not going to be able to get electricity and the grid is going to be impacted and all of that. And even when we look at the engineering of the thing, that should not be taken at face value. There's a lot of redundancy in the grid. And so the Light and Power, contrary to what people think about my opinion about Light and Power's grid is engineered for resilience. The question is whether they have continued to maintain the grid and upgrade the grid in a manner as to ensure that we don't have the outages that we've experienced here of late. And that requires reinvestment. So you cannot take up 90% of your net earnings and send it away. Mm-hmm. Instead of investing the 70% that you used to invest before and expect that it will be business as usual. No, it will not be. And I believe that the Barbados government, particularly with a license review, not a license review, they say that they will be looking at a license application very shortly. We need to look at how we manage our electricity sector and the extent to which we permit a single shareholder or they say that each licensee will have to have 30% shareholding, local shareholding. And again, what does that mean? Does that mean a single person who has a 30%, or does that mean you have wide ownership? So you require public trading of those shares, which is what I think ought to happen. And then as far as the Barbados Light and Power, will that apply to them? Because right now they're 100% owned by a single shareholder. So what you say to them, in getting a license, there has to be local shareholding. That's that. There is complete silence on that issue. And that is the way that it should be, at least. Barbados, for me, our government should be the majority shareholder in that company. There should be, or Barbadians, there should be a percentage owned by the national insurance scheme, because the company earns good money, and that should redound to the benefit of Barbadians from an investment perspective. And this is Tricia now with spouting what I think should happen. And then a portion of the shares should be publicly traded, so that if you want to go take up a couple thousand dollars and buy some shares, right, you can do that. That's the way I think it ought to be.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Ms. Watson. There is another question here, and then I know Caswell is beaming with questions. And Ms. McLean, she's trying to get on her technical issue, their technical issues. But the question is, what is the true role of the FTC in this matter? And in your opinion, Ms. Watson, is this organization fulfilling its mandate?
The FTC's primary mandate is as a consumer protection agency. There may seem to be a dichotomy when you look at how the FTC has to go about setting rates, but underlying it all is that the FTC has to protect consumers. So when the Light and Power says rates have to be fair and reasonable, it isn't rates have to be fair and reasonable to the utility. Rates have to be fair and reasonable. So that also takes into consideration affordability for consumers and their particular prescriptions, like the FTC has to consider inflation, for example, during the period before the application and so on. Certainly, if the FTC was considering inflation in the economy, they wouldn't be able to grant rate increases at this present time. They'd have to look at what we've been contending with and say, well, no, inflation is problematic. So if you're asking if the FTC has been the consumer protector in this process, as a consumer intervener, the answer is no. Flat out, I have no qualms in saying it. The procedure has been used, their procedural control has been used against interveners who write the FTC, and the FTC doesn't even condescend to answer. There are applications that have been filed with the FTC that they simply have not addressed, and I don't mean by Barbados Light and Power, they hop, skip, and jump when Barbados Light and Power sends anything to them. I already gave you an illustration of the FTC saying to me, no, we're not going to compel the Light and Power to answer your interrogatories, and then 2 days later sent interrogatories in the same matter. And then if you just look at the rudiments of rate setting, what you have to do in setting a rate, you have to, even when we look at renewable energy, we cannot say that the rate setting that has occurred in the last few years has been protective of consumers. How can we? When the entire discussion tonight has been about the inflation, electricity specific inflation, the amount of additional costs that we have been paying. And there's a lot of, and you know, people will say, oh, the FTC is burdened, they have a lot of work to do, et cetera, et cetera. Perhaps so. But that doesn't change what we have experienced, and it doesn't change the facts. our electricity prices are increasing appreciably. We could feel it. It's not a small amount of money that you could say, it's not too much. I could handle it. And I don't see how a regulator who has to contemplate giving a fair and reasonable rate can ignore the impact, the inflationary impact of those price increases. And they can't ignore the data. They can't allow the company to not provide the data. Maybe the FTC has it. We don't know. But I will give you an illustration. We found in asking interrogatories that when the company would answer, provide tables, they would just send a photo of a table. And we said, well, Kadir, we have to be able to analyze the information, so we need a spreadsheet. And that was ignored. And eventually, I wrote to the FTC and I said, we need this information provided in a format where we can do the analysis. You're talking about a company with hundreds of, well, thousands, if you look at Emera, and billions of dollars, versus an intervener who may have two people on their team, and this is not our job, really. We actually have jobs and businesses. And so can you give us the data in a way that we can deal with it? And the FTC actually never responded to that letter. And in my letter, I said, I'm going to assume you get it in a format that you can analyze. Shortly thereafter, the FTC wrote to the Barbados Light and Power asking for it to provide data back to it in a format that it could analyze. So that suggested to me that it was getting the same format that we were getting. And throughout the FTC's decision, where they talk about transparency, throughout that February 2023 decision, the FTC says, we want the data in its native format by Excel spreadsheet, etc. Explicit every single request. They restate that, which says to me that they too were getting the data, because they wouldn't have to tell them that if they were getting it in a format, in an appropriate format. So they had to demand that as a regulator. I find that to be extraordinary.
Yes. Wow. Let me just say we've received your questions, but I realize that Ms. Watson has answered a lot of those questions because the presentation was quite extensive. So a lot of those questions, and we don't want to repeat. We do have just a short time left in this segment. Probably another 15 minutes, but it's going so good. But we'll see. But let me hear from Mr. Franklin at this point, and then we will ask a few more questions.
Good night, everyone, and a special good night to you, Senator Watson. I know I love to say
thank you, Senator Watson. Everyone, most people that believe that title doesn't go away, and that we should treat people who perform that role accordingly, and in particular that our Prime Minister should be treated with certain respect and perks after they have demitted office. That's how I feel, regardless of who it is.
Yeah. You know, I'm so pleased, you know, and especially when I see you perform in the Senate. You have to be doing a remarkable job, because it has the other side uneasy. They wouldn't want you to talk. They just interrupt the foolishness. And they said, look, she's destroying those people. You know, but what they're doing, they're destroying themselves, because they make themselves look really silly. And I'm so proud of you. I couldn't be prouder. I worked on a lot of questions, but I know I can't ask, so Marcy would stop me. But I want to ask you, you're a lawyer, and something was bothering me for the longest time. You know, if the law requires a person to be an attorney at law, to chair a panel, whatever panel that is, shouldn't the person who deputizes for that person also be an attorney at law? I know if it was a constitutional post, the Constitution requires that. Section 117(4) provides for that, but I'm not talking about a constitutional post, but I think the principle applies, because you can put Ding Ding as deputy. I think that in some cases they have. But then it makes a mockery.
Right. I think I understand what you're saying. And the FTC is a board. So you have the statutory entity, corporation. I actually think it's a corporation. So you have the commission itself, the people who sit as a panel in whatever matter, competition, rate setting, consumer protection matters. They are the board. And then they also perform the role as the panel. So the legislation says the chairman of the commission must be an attorney, but it does say that you can form a panel to have a hearing in a matter, and it does not have a prescription. And therein lies the issue, because it has that dual role to play. And what I will say is that I think from the beginning, panels have been chaired by, we've had panels chaired by non-lawyers, and this isn't new this time around. The chairs always have been attorneys, but they will have panels for telecoms, they'll have panels for electricity, and then they will have panels if they have competition matters, etc. So I don't think it requires that the panel be chaired by an attorney, because of how that particular provision is written. It is not prescriptive, actually.
No, that's not what I'm asking. I'm saying I actually feel it shouldn't be, because the person has to decide on legal submissions. And
so I'll answer that. I think that might serve a purpose, but the FTC has lawyers. So it has its general counsel. In this case, it has two external counsel. And there are QCs, KCs, SCs, however they want to call themselves. And the FTC has always done that. It's only, I think, in maybe one or two cases, they decided to forego having counsel. Certainly in cases that I've sat in, counsel sat right next to the chairman and whispering in the chairman's ear, including with the chairman as an attorney. So the first chair of the Fair Trading Commission was Justice Frank King.
Frank King.
Mm-hmm. And even with Frank King chairing matters, counsel advised the panel. Because as you know what we would say, we don't advise ourselves. You don't advise mm-hmm. yourself as a client. And so you still will defer to having that person, particularly with the expertise, who can, because you could have an attorney who is, who doesn't know anything about public law, for example. That's not what they practice. And so they could misdirect themselves. And so I don't like the idea that you're going to then embody. I know that happens with the Employment Rights Tribunal. I don't think that is necessarily the right thing to do either, unless you're going to have professional tribunal members. So that's their job. That's all they do, so they can direct themselves. I don't like the mechanism where you're asking somebody who's going to be doing this on an ad hoc basis to direct themselves in panel. That's my own position, I think. And we have a different model. A lot of jurisdictions, their model actually is, you have a decision-making body. They don't get into the fray. The staff of the regulator presents a case. The company presents a case. And consumer representatives, oftentimes including a government consumer advocate, presents a case. And then the tribunal will make a decision. That's not our model. I think that's the best model, frankly. But that's not our model.
That brings me to my question, not final question, but I'll let somebody else get in. No, but
just to make a comment. Because of the time, and somebody here is telling me that if I try to stop, they said, I'm trying not to be rude, but if you try to stop Senator Watson, I'm going to protest the show. That's what I'm saying. I'm going to need a protest
against me. Well, Marcia, I might follow them.
Okay, so Mr. Franklin,
I might follow them. So.
So, Mr. Franklin, please keep your questions really short.
No, this is just a comment that I want to make, you know, because people do not understand the value of the work that Senator Watson and the other divinities have put in. You know, they think that interveners get this great sums of money and all kind of stuff, you know. And I want the public to know that we owe her and the other interveners a great debt of gratitude. And it should not only be gratitude, it should be something other than just gratitude, because these things come out of their pockets.
Yeah.
They don't get a stipend from the government. They don't get anything. So when you see her out there fighting against these people, she is doing this out of the goodness of her heart, out of the care. You know, and but she don't pretend to care about people. You know, she actually cares. Because if she, I see what you're laughing at. If she didn't really care about people, she would go there and earn money in her profession, and let the people suffer the consequences of their actions. You know what I mean? But no. So I think people must know. And then too, you know, you go to the Senate and they give you $1,500 to, you know.
Oh, it's not $1,645. That's an issue that the country needs to address. Maybe parliamentary reform will address that. But I do want to take that point. That's a really important point. And it's a matter that interveners have been grappling with for some time. It even went as far as there being a judicial opinion rendered on it. And I put up my hand and say, I work for a company that fought against interveners getting money. I'm paying for my sins. But it's a lot of time and effort, obviously. Right now, we're juggling three cases. And what happens in the end is that while interveners can say, can I get my costs? The experience, traditionally, the FTC has awarded very small amounts, and it's been like pulling teeth from a hen. Their approach is to try to minimize what the interveners will get. And we anticipate that we will have a fight on our hands to recover the costs that we have invested. And Caswell, you're right. If I was billing for this time, I wouldn't be here. I'd be off on my little round the world trip in 5-star hotels at this stage, because believe me, that's the kind of consulting and fees that are being spent by the other players in this. And the rate payers will pay the cost, the allowed cost of the company for the hearing, and they will pay the FTC's costs, all of them. And that's the fees to the panel, their external consultant, their attorneys, etc. And we will then have to come around at the end and say, well, pay us as well. And we will have to prove that we are, to the FTC, that we are entitled. And they will raise things like, were you cooperative? They will have to say, I wasn't cooperative, because I don't sit back and let the FTC get away with the things that I think are wrong. They like to say that that is delay and all that. They write me regularly and say, you waited too long to file a motion or something like that, notwithstanding that I may have written 3 or 4 letters and they didn't answer any of them, things like that. So we know that that is coming up. We will have to deal with that. I can see, obviously I can see the comments. And luckily, this time around, we have been doing electronic filings, but that doesn't change the fact that they have to be produced. Obviously, I'm spending electricity money doing work on this matter and filing documents. I have a team, like I said, all business people, self-employed Barbadians, young attorneys who have to have earnings as well. And we are battling, when we deal with the Light and Power as an applicant, we're dealing with Emera, a $4 billion company. And we, certainly in one case, they have a firm, the firm has at least 30 lawyers in it. And we have to come up against that. And we have to be able to perform. It's that simple. So we can't come in there with, you know, half-baked presentations. We are very thorough, as you may have noticed. We do the analysis. We demand the information. And that requires a lot of effort, obviously skill, experience, etc. And by we, I mean all of the interveners who've been involved in this process. And we have, for example, on Mr. Wendt's team, we have one of the world's foremost depreciation experts working for Barbadians. And he's retired, But he is an expert that cable and wireless used to use in its depreciation applications. And so we try to cooperate as well on certain aspects of our cases so that we're not duplicating, or we can support each other when necessary. And, you know, we may bounce one or two things off each other. But certainly in relation to procedural fairness and protecting interveners, I do not brag. I will pat myself on the back, but I will be frank. I am the person who has been fighting for interveners to be treated fairly. And by interveners, there is one intervener that supports rate increases, and that's the Barbados Renewable Energy Association. They have supported the increases regardless of the applications. But I have been, I constantly am saying to the FTC, no, you have to do this fairly. Procedural fairness is important because that is a key tenet of the law when you're dealing with a matter like this, where there's a tribunal. And you cannot overlook those issues. And I've had to write on behalf of other interveners, quarrel I won't say a quarrel, make submissions in hearings in defense of other interveners. And that is essential to ensure that a fair playing field is set. It hasn't been fair, but we've clawed back a lot of rights for interveners. And yes, that started, I do just give one final bit of background. For me, that work started when the FTC first filed its application for rate increases in 2021. And just reading in the press, application for rate increase filed, so okay, fine. And then the next thing you know, we saw the Fair Training Commission, then acting CEO, now CEO, say they've asked for an interim rate and they've asked for confidentiality of those 470 pages. That's my aside. While we wait for interveners, and that's a complex process, which it actually isn't, we are going to consider those two requests. I'm sitting in my office, kind of minding my own business. I said to myself, but that's not right. You can't do that. That is legally wrong. And I wrote to the FTC in November 2021 to say you cannot do that. And if you do it, I am going to take action, because you cannot make a decision in a rate case without consulting the public. And the consultation process in the rate case is the intervention process. You cannot do it before you've even invited interventions, or at least processed the applications and approved interventions. And so that when I say I've been saving money all that while, I've saved 100 something million dollars. That's what I mean, because the Light and Power had asked for those rates to kick in 100% from the 1st of November 2021. That 50% rate was granted and only commenced in October 2022. And even with that process, I had to say to the FTC, no, you cannot have a consultation. You have to have a rate hearing. It's a rate. And while I don't approve of how they went about doing it, they at least didn't try to have some low paper exchange and treat it as just a low consultation. And in order to set a rate of millions of dollars, you know, affecting Barbadians. So I think it is important for us to pay attention, and where possible, also because people will ask, what can I do? There's obviously the opportunity to support. People will support financially in particular if they can, and those mechanisms. I would have to say I've been somewhat hesitant to set up that mechanism, because there are the implications of managing a fund, as you would know. Marcia, you and I have talked about that a little bit. Mm-hmm. But we're still looking at how it can be done, because the truth is many, many people say, how can I contribute? And that's the mechanism, that's the mode.
If I can jump in here, Ms. Watson, one of the things, some people are sending me messages already, and they want to give. And so just so you know, this was not the intention of Ms. Watson coming on here, because once money mentioned, you know how we are as Bajans, and we started, she did not ask for this at all. But I had this in my mind, and people are messaging my phone and saying, can we set aside a time to raise money for her and her team? And so, Mr. Franklin, you know, I'd like to confer with you about these things. So we'll talk about it. I'm just saying that this is something that people are sending me messages on. And it's just natural for us as Barbadians to want.
That
to
is why something. I raised it.
Yes.
That is why I raised it, because I wanted the public to know that she is digging deep into her pockets. Well, I don't know if she has deep pockets, but I mean she's digging into her pockets to protect Barbadians. You know, something I think the government should intervene in this case, because there's nothing wrong with the government intervening.
The government intervened.
You know?
I will also say this, the government started becoming an intervener in electricity, feeding tariffs in particular, when I was chair of the Electrolyte and Power Advisory Committee, and the FTC put out its first consultation on a feeding tariff, and the ministry said, well, we don't think we like how they're going about it. I said, well, intervene. There was a big discussion about it. And I said, intervene and let them tell you you can't intervene. Just do it. I'm one of those people that said, when it comes to my children, to say, do an act and beg forgiveness afterwards. They don't get to do that, but they still try. But I thought that was necessary. And in the 2021 rate case, actually, the government did intervene. The Ministry of Commerce and the ministry responsible, the Division of Energy, intervened. And Commerce withdrew their application just before the rate case. They just didn't participate. And the Division of Energy did participate and were helpful in some respects. And they did have a consultant and whatnot. And then they pulled back. I put it that way. And everybody can surmise why they pulled back, because they pulled back at the same time that interveners were being criticized and put under pressure for doing our advocacy. And but the government as an intervener is important. And intervention doesn't necessarily mean objecting. You can intervene to support, which is what Bria has done. And so intervention is a neutral word. Mm-hmm. We have come culturally to assume that an intervener is an objector, and that's the term that is used, and it's been used interchangeably with that term. But an intervener simply comes and says, I am going to participate in this process, and I will make submissions according to the information that I have and whatnot. And in fact, with the electricity licensing for large systems, and I do want to flag that as something for your viewers to look out for, because we understand that the government is going to proceed to deal with Light and Power's application for a license. You can intervene in that process. I think it is really important for Barbadians to pay attention. A notice would come out. You have 30 days after the initial notice, so you'd have to comb the papers and pay attention to what's going on. And then you can, the legislation says make representation. So again, that's neutral. You can either say, yes, by all means, give them. They are a wonderful company, you know, let them have their license. Or you can say, but we have concerns about licensing the entity and hear our concerns and insist that they be heard. And yes. I have intervened. I intervened in their, they put out a notice in 2021, September, and I intervened and heard nothing. And then I would write intermittently and say, so what's going on with this? And I was requesting information. And you remember there was the initial app, the amendment to the legislation that said, you could, even if you're an intervener, they don't necessarily have to give you the information, the application, and then they can keep information confidential and you have to show that you have an interest. And then afterward, after that legislation was passed, and I wrote and said, so tell me about my intervention. My intervention is pre that legislation and I want to understand where the process is. They wrote me and said, well, actually, they only ever published a notice. They never applied for a license. We will not comment on that. But they now have to apply, apparently, because their license expires August 2028. Uh-huh. And so I will say, pay attention to that. That is important. And we need to utilize that representation to the minister process, even if it is a simple letter saying, I have a concern about what I have observed and I want to be heard.
Yes.
And so that, you know, we are participating in a process that's been set up for us and it doesn't become owned either by people with power, no pun intended, or it doesn't become dismissed and the people who are affected by the license sidelined. Because I think you would realize that there are a lot of meetings, a lot of stakeholder consultations and all that, and the consumers aren't in the room. We need to get
But you know, boy,
I love CD.
Yeah. Let me see. That's so true. Let me see if Miss McLean.
I assure you that we're not just using a sling and stones, though. We got some serious brain power and effort.
We could tell. Former Senator McLean, finally we get you on. We've been having
I am just turning on.
In the room.
I'm just turning on my camera because I don't know if it's your program, Marcia, but my computer's hard drive crashed. I was trying to get on my tablet and I was having some issues with sound, so I'm on my cell phone. But I wanted to Tricia to see that this is not AI generated or any such thing. This is me. Senator Watson, I have some questions, but I think what I will do is to turn my questions into a couple comments quickly, because I want first to say, Marcia, that this is the first opportunity that Barbadians have had to really hear a comprehensive presentation on this issue. I think for me, it is highly technical. You recognize that and you were saying so. And I want to say, for me, this is also very personal. You may not know, Marcia, or maybe you do, but for 3 decades, one of my brothers did what Tricia is doing. And he did it in the same vein for love of country. And I believe, while I agree that we should look to support, I would also make the argument that government has to make provision to pay interveners. My brother Wendell took on Light and Power. He took on Cable and Wireless, and I smiled when you spoke about Mr. Wendt, because I think some of his teeth would have been sharpened sitting on the opposite side of the table from Wendell.
His teeth were sharpened at Combermere, Maxine.
Yes, sir. Up and on. And seriously, because for me, when I listened to your presentation tonight and I've followed the hearings, I recognize what you are doing for this country. And I was gonna ask some questions, but I'm just gonna make some comments, which I think I extracted from your presentation. And I would have been raising questions. And really and truly, at the end of the day, what we are talking about is what I see to be an extremely complex exercise in which Tricia is looking to determine exactly, and the question is, what exactly is in this for the average Barbadian when we talk about renewable energy? These households who, from what you're hearing, will end up probably having to address the question of energy stability, you know, the provision of stable energy supplies. The costs, as you said, seem to go up. And you mentioned it, the notion that share the burden, share the bounty, or the benefits. And the question I would raise from there is, who exactly are the people who currently are benefiting? Because at the end of the day, we have had a policy, an energy policy in terms of renewable energy. We have also had a set of people who have been able to access the business opportunity, let me call it that, that there has been generated by this. And the question is, how has that who are the main beneficiaries of the opportunities created by the ability to access the what I would call the national grid supplying solar generated energy at this point in time? And what are the consequences of that? So I am happy that you've been able to explain a lot of the technical elements of that, but to also demonstrate perhaps how the implementation of those policies have impacted certain groups. In this case, I look at it from the perspective of suppliers, how it is impacting the users of energy. You've also touched on how the company's policy, because I was going to ask some questions, but I think you went into that when you talked about the whole question of the 2009 application and the proposed retiring of the plant, and then the final decision back in 2022, if I am correct. And the implications, you also touched on the issue of funds which were supposed to be part of a self-insurance mechanism. Mm-hmm. And what has happened, because the question I had written was, what has happened to those funds? But I think you indicated that that in essence, if I understood correctly, not only what you say, but what was said before, those funds would have probably been distributed as dividends.
Oh, they were. Some sense. And so you know, to quickly talk about that, the fund in about 2016, I believe, the company took about $100 million out of that fund. The fund had I think about 100, and you know, there's so much of this information that sometimes it's hard to pull on it. And the fund was, the company set up a self-insurance fund.
Right.
The company set up a self-insurance fund a few decades ago, and that was because these companies, because the same thing happened with CNW, were finding it difficult because of the hurricane propensity for hurricanes to find insurance at all, or to be able
at risk,
to
good risk, reasonable
rate. So they went about setting up funds, and what happened with the BLPC is that they were eventually able to have that fund set up as a regulated fund, so regulated by the Financial Services Commission, as well, that's what it's known as now. And so it's actually a statutory fund. And at some point, the company said, you know, this fund is overcapitalized. That's the language that they used. And they're going to take out some of the money. They're going to take out some of the money out of that fund and pay it to, so that would be BLPC, taking the money out of the fund and paying it to its shareholder. And I'm just going to get the self-insurance fund numbers for you. And right. So the self-insurance, the money that was in the fund and what was taken out. And they went through a little discussion with the entities. So you, this out the Financial Services Commission, the Fair Trading Commission, and the Central Bank, because the monies were
yeah.
that they were paying out. The long and short of it is a significant amount of money was taken out of that fund, and there was not replacement insurance as far as we could see. In the meantime, in the 2009 application, the Barbados Life and Power specifically asked for somewhere between $7 and $8 million per annum to be put into the rates to then go into the self-insurance fund. You understand? Let me repeat it. Let us include in the rates let's say $7.5 million annually to go into the rates. In the first year, the Barbados Light and Power and the FCC said, yes, that's reasonable because the insurance is important. So that's fine. Nobody's quarreling with that. The Barbados Light and Power then paid into the fund, I think it was like $1.4 million the first year, the second year, maybe the third year. I'm getting the numbers, and then did not pay another cent of that money into the fund. To the contrary, they then took a significant amount of money out of the fund. And when we look at those numbers and, you know, put on some interest for investment and whatnot, there is a significant amount of money that was confiscated from consumers. And they still haven't said what they have done with that money collected in the rates. What we also, in that rate case, we ask questions about. So what we were looking at the fund having total assets of $146 million in 2015. And in 2016, that was reduced after the funds were taken out, that was reduced to $50 million. So you can see the kind of money that they took out. And over $100
million. Million, yeah.
When we ask for information, and the way it's supposed to work is that the fund is set up to cover generation assets and transmission and distribution assets, and possibly premiums, because that's in the statute. And so that money having been taken out, our question was, are these assets covered? And after a lot of prevarication and beating around the bush and whatnot, we got a document from a reinsurer that had, I think, some amount of coverage, certainly not covering the total amount of assets, nowhere near, that was dated the date that it was submitted to the FTC in October 2022. This is not a joke. So what would we have to draw from that? That the assets were not adequately covered. And so again, we come back to the issue of resilience. If we have a catastrophic event, would our grid be covered from an insurance perspective? And based on what is before the FTC, I would have to say no. What the FTC said in its decision is you have to put, you have to create a regulatory account. This is a mechanism where you're saying give back for over confiscation, for example. So create a regulatory account, and you will have to, if there is a need to draw from that self-insurance fund, you will draw from the self-insurance fund, but you have to put that money in that way. And there's a mechanism that they ordered for the company to compensate consumers for what, you know, they have done in relation to the self-insurance fund over 30 years, I believe. So again, that's one of our arguments. They took the money out in one fell swoop. Why are they getting 30 years to return that money? In the meantime, we're facing hurricanes every year. And so these kinds of things happened in the market. So, you know, Maxine, when you ask that question, it is very pertinent because we have an ongoing operator. The operator still has to function. We still have to be concerned about whether it is functioning in the manner that it should.
I suppose.
Which is why I say we have to be involved in the issue of licensing, and we have to pay, and we need to be asking for what those new licenses will have in them, because we need to be sure that the company, the government is requiring the grid operator to do what is necessary to supply consistent, safe, affordable electricity to this country, to us as ratepayers. When you, just to go back a little on the issue of paying interveners, that has to be done as a matter of policy. A lot of countries, yes. Jurisdictions just have a well-funded, well-resourced consumer advocate, or their Attorney General's office will do it. We have the Office of Public Counsel. There are a lot of things that we can say about that. But I, as an intervener, would not go to public counsel because I am technically able to do it myself. That's number one. So if I am technically able to do it myself, and I am running my case, and it doesn't duplicate public counsels or what have you, then that has to be taken for what it's worth. And keep in mind that public counsel does not supplant the individual intervener. That's not our system. So that you have it serious about consultation, the value of consultation. And I could go on for another hour or so about what the law says about what consultation actually means. But if you're serious about that, and you're serious about having, and our history for 70 years now is that interveners have enhanced the rate setting process indisputably. And we hold up the late Mr. McLean as, again, a senator, the late Senator McLean, as an example of how an individual advocate has contributed to that process. And we've seen that throughout. And if the government either has to properly resource a public advocate, give it the staff, the expertise, the funds, which it does not do with public counsel, the Office of Public Counsel, or it has to say interveners are paid in this way. And serious jurisdictions say, this is how we compensate interveners. And they have a mechanism, they have a formula. They have a mechanism by which you apply, and everybody understands that that's the way it's going to work. You're not coming at the end begging and hoping that the regulator will be kind.
What I would suggest, Marcy, in terms of that, and this is something that we can do as persons here involved, is to do the research and identify the kind of options that exist, because I really believe it should be something that is set up because of the nature of what they do. As people would have heard from the presentation, the sheer complexity of what exists or what has to happen in this kind of exercise. And so I think that's the critical thing. The last point I would make, and this is not necessarily for a response now, but I would suggest to those who are participating in the show, listening and so on, go and, because there was a question raised about the experience in the rest of the in the Eastern Caribbean, for example. And I would say go and do some research on the history of Emira as a company within its jurisdiction as well as elsewhere. And it should make for some interesting reading. But I really want just again to thank you for what to me should have been an eye-opener for a lot of people, and for the ease with which you are able to share the kind of information that you were able to readily share to help us to understand what's really involved in this process, and to help us better appreciate the public's service that you're doing for and on behalf of Barbadians.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Thank you so much.
Sometimes I say that and I say, I think. But I also want to just say one other thing, because Maxine did raise the issue of who's benefiting. And that is an excellent question. First movers, people with the funds to have gotten in there early. And when they fall off, and keep in mind that I said there are many small power producers who are now not earning a return. They're paying electricity rates, and those rates keep going up. So we're talking about those who can have those large systems. And I've said elsewhere that they're gaming the system because of how they've been granted licenses. And so they're being permitted the highest possible returns. And then when the FTC did its most recent review of the feed-in tariffs, the FTC increased the tariff in the category with the largest systems, which didn't make any sense because economies of scale and scope and whatnot, and reducing costs of the components, their costs should actually have remained static or should have gone down. It should not have increased, in my view. And unfortunately, my team has not been able to intervene in any of those consultations, simply because we do not have the bandwidth. And so when you see who intervenes in those consultations, it's inevitably those large players or their lobbying organization. That is a fact. And so what I've done today, which is to write the FTC and say, no, you cannot set a rate for an unlicensed entity. That's something that I've done previously, but it's not something that I can do consistently. And I sent the letter. If they're so minded, they can tell me you didn't meet the deadline because you're doing other stuff. And my own approach to it is, but I'm not engaging in your consultation. I am telling you as an advocate, you cannot do what you're purporting to do.
Yeah. Wow. This is, I just want to say, Senator Watson, thank you so much for educating us tonight. And I see a lot of people are asking, they want to help. They want to help. We're going to have some discussion on it because we try our best to organize ourselves. As you know, we're more than a talk show. We're action. We're people of action. And we want to jump in there and to assist. Having heard such an extensive presentation, insightful, educational, informative presentation, I can see that we are inspired and agitated to get out there and to give that support. And we're going to come back to you we're going to have some discussions and then come back to you to see how, at least in the interim, how we can assist Senator Watson until you are able, whatever you choose to do, but just as something from our show to you. Mm-hmm. To see how and your organization, to see how we can help. And that's how we want to say thanks, not just with our words, but, in our pocket, with our pockets, right? We want to say thank you.
Thank you for that offer.
Yes.
Thank you. Well, we can have a chat about it.
I want to jump in to say this to make it clear again. And you know me, I'm going to tell you the truth. She did not come on here. That was not the purpose of her coming on this show. So please, let's just get that out of the way. This is something that just happened organically while we were on the show. Yes, Senator Watson, and then I'm going to jump right in back into the details for our motorcade on Sunday. Go ahead, Senator Watson. Final thoughts.
Final thoughts. I want to say, first of all, thank you for inviting me on. And thank you for giving me far more time than we originally said. But I did tell you that I thought that we would go way beyond an hour.
Yes,
because there's a lot. There's a lot to digest and there's a lot.
People
that
are going to protest against me. So.
I wonder who was going to organize that process. Was it you, Caswell? But it's important. And we've been at it for a long time and there are multiple things going on. I also want to say this to the people. The leader of the opposition, Mr. Thorne, is the attorney for my team in the High Court appeal. So you can see, yes, you can, and he volunteered. And you can see then how people who have been observers and seeing what's going on have found ways to contribute. And so we're a team working together in that application before the High Court. What I will say is it's important to pay attention. Far too often, these things are happening in Barbados and they're affecting us, but we, I don't know what it is, we're trusting, we are, I don't know, numbed, we are lazy, we're something, but we are not paying attention to the matters that affect us. And then it hits us by whatever means, in whatever way, and then we say, oh my goodness, I didn't know that that was going on. But we feel electricity every month. So we know that it is going on. And I want to appeal to your audience to continue to pay attention and to agitate. And you can agitate sometimes just by when the government, let's say, tables a policy in Parliament or a new legislation, you can go online. And I think that we have actually had some response. Okay, in the main, they probably just cussed us and said that we're wicked and causing eruption and so on, but they've had to pay attention and at least explain or hold back, because even in instances where I think the government intended to act, because there is scrutiny of what they're doing, they have had to pull back. That is effective advocacy as well. And so we have to continue to pay attention. Don't let it fall by the wayside. You can see from the presentation how this is going to affect you directly in your daily life. And so keep your eyes on what's going on. Don't be distracted. And we will have to harness our collective energy, be energized, and ensure that whatever happens in this sector, we get the benefits, not just a select few, not just a particular class or a couple of political classes, but that Barbadians are positively impacted, even if it means that it only means that you can tolerate the cost of your bill. For me, it has to be far more than that. But that's what we're talking about. The benefit and the bounty, to use the Prime Minister's words, redound to the regular Barbadian, the regular consumer. All of us can say, this thing happened in our country, this transformation, and it suited us and it affected us positively.
Yes. Wow. Excellent. And I'm going to ask you in front of the people because they're messaging me. Ma'am, can you come back very, very, very soon? The people are asking you to come back. And, you know, so you have to think about it and let me know.
I'll think about it. There's a lot more that we can talk about. So there's the rate setting side, but then there is the sector policy and transformation side that, as Beijing would say, it won't talk about.
Because we had some questions about that. I chose not to present those tonight because that would have taken us in another direction. But I want to thank you, and I want you to please consider, we're going to talk off air about you coming back, and I think Barbadians are ready to listen. And the last thing I'll say before this, I call her Harriet Tubman, because when I watched her in the Senate, I didn't even know this much about her, Mr. Franklin. I could not stop watching her presentation in the last Senate, in the debate, the appropriations bill debate. I could not stop. And what came in my mind is Harriet Tubman. And I just want to say that this is the kind of service that Barbados needs. When I listen to them, when I sing the national anthem, and when I listen to the national anthem, and when I feel it, as a Barbadian, this is the kind of service that it invokes in me, that I'm seeing in you. And to the people who say, oh, well, you know, all of the people who are in government, they are the brightest people. If this person goes, who else? I say, really? Look at what Barbados has produced. Look at them. Look at her team.
For me, I simplify it with a very simple motto. From each according to his ability. Barbados has come to where it is because regular Barbadians contributed to our development. For us to sit back and think it can only be the 30 or the 51 or whatever the numbers are, because it's in the main, the people who are not for the government are ignored. So to think that it's just a select few, whether it's capital or what I call the included, are the ones who have the answers. We can't look at our country in this way. And whatever capacity you have to serve, then you serve. And my own approach was to say, this is my particular skill, and I can have an appreciable, it means you could feel it, mm-hmm. right? Feel it. I can have an appreciable impact on an aspect of our lives, on a sector that impacts us every single day. And it was not an easy decision to make, because we had to literally do the numbers as a functioning household, frankly, because I do work so that I can support my household and time, and come to a decision about how we thought that we could manage doing this work. Contemplate what it would mean, because let's be frank, I have been attacked. So you also had to anticipate that there would be some negative reaction. And so you had to put all of that in the basket and make a decision about whether we would do what so many people have done, is to say, you know, it's true, I can mind my own business. But when you mind your own business, you still got be participating in the economy and in the society. And if a portion of society cannot afford to live, it must impact you. It must.
Yes.
And so we holistically made that decision. And I think it is possible for every Barbadian in their own way to participate in shaping our society and our economy.
Yes, yes. Thank you, Senator Watson. And we look forward with keen anticipation for the next time you are on this show. Thank you so very much.
Thank you, everyone, for listening and for participating. Thank you so much. Yes. Thank you for making me feel welcome.
Thank you.
We're going to show that video right now. We're going to show if Dave could get that video shown right now, even in absence.
Yes, and I think to say what the minister is saying is absolutely correct.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you so much, Mrs. Watson. Thank you. If we could play that video, because we promised that we would do that, and we might go over a little bit tonight, Mr. Franklin, because we have a big weekend coming up. But that was absolutely brilliant. Can we have that video now? That we could not get. All the rest of the presentation, Mr. Franklin, flowed well. It's just that one video would not play. So let's see if it will play now.
When you're focusing on price, a country is able to drive down the price of these renewable energy technologies and therefore drive down the cost of energy to the consumer. I mean, I first started hearing about competitive bidding for renewable energy probably around 2006, 2007. But the idea is that if you are able to make price very transparent, that is going to drive down the cost of the projects. That is going to drive down the cost of the projects. It's going to drive down the cost of the technologies and the implementation of the technologies. There needs now to be another transmission mechanism, another pathway by which driving down the cost of the project to execute means driving down the cost of energy to the consumer. One does not necessarily follow the other unless we are very careful to make sure that that happens.
Yeah. Wow. And that's really what, and as she said, it's correct. But we're going to, as you said, we're going to bring her on again. Mr. Franklin, oh my goodness, we are 9:49, and it didn't feel that long. Oh Lord, I wasn't supposed to have gone that way, but it went, and it was beautiful. I'm seeing Nigel on, and Nigel, the most we can do is to read that story, a short story that Nigel has for us that he's written, and then he is going to put it in context of our motorcade protest and cookout that we have on Sunday, which, as I said, we're not just a talk show, guys, but we are people of action. And so we're inviting everybody to come. So Nigel, welcome, Mr. Watson. Welcome to the Marcia Week Show. And I know you have a short story that you want to read for us. And go right ahead, sir.
Yes, thank you very much, Marcia. Good night, Caswell. Good night, everyone.
Good night, Nigel.
This is a story that I wrote back on July 7, 1997, after my presentation to the 1997, my presentation was to the Ford Commission on Constitutional Reform. And this story, in fact, the article I'm reading to you tonight is based on a story my father would tell us each night when we were all children. In those days, we had no electricity, no radio, nothing. And he would tell us stories at night until we go to sleep. And I'll share this. This article is based on that story. Fellow Barbadians, have you ever heard the story of Justice Monkey and the cats? Well, according to my father, two cats found a piece of cheese. In the midst of their jubilation, a bitter dispute ensued. Each cat wanted all of the cheese. In desperation, they invited Justice Monkey to settle their dispute. Justice Monkey welcomed the opportunity. Seated before his scales, Justice Monkey invited the cats to observe how he planned to settle their dispute. He divided the cheese into two parts and placed them into the scales. The piece on the left side was too heavy. To ensure that each cat received an equal share, he lifted the heavier piece of cheese. He lifted the heavier piece of cheese, the scales to the right plummeted. He bit off a piece of the cheese, and the scale to the right plummeted. Again, Justice Monkey exclaimed, "Too heavy," lifted the cheese, bit off another piece, and returned it to the scales. Suddenly, the left side of the scale plummeted. Justice Monkey continued biting and shouting, "Too heavy, too heavy." The cat sat quietly looking from left to right as the monkey ate away. Soon, the monkey found himself with the last piece of cheese. He looked up, looked at each cat, looked at the cheese and said, "Too heavy." Justice Monkey lifted the cheese and ate it all. As he looked quizzically at the scales and the cats, he exclaimed, "Well, It has been divided. Our island, Barbados, is 166 square miles. Its population at that time was 265,000 persons. African Barbadians constituted 93% of the population. Throughout our history, African and Europeans coexisted. However, we were powerless slaves. Europeans controlled everything. Persistent rebellion and non-cooperation brought freedom and a gradual shift in the power relationship. Hence, we now have a limited say in the management of national affairs. Unfortunately, after 30 years of independence, we cannot agree on the ownership and control of the country. As a result, the lords of poverty are meddling in the governance of Barbados. Lord Justice Monkey, IMF World Bank, imposed an 18-month period of structural adjustment. On his departure, Lord Justice Monkey, Inter-American Development Bank, took charge and imposed a devastating sentence, the Investment Sector Reform Program. This program is contemptuous of our land use policy. Traditionally, the Physical Development Plan and the Town and Country Planning Department protected our agricultural land and our agricultural land and land use policy. Land could not be easily taken out of agriculture since Parliament was responsible for any such action. Now, with the interference of Lord Justice Monkey IADB, catastrophe reigns. Prime agricultural lands are abandoned, sold to foreigners for golf course development, or lots for luxury villas. Fellow Barbadians, our country is being eaten up by aliens. Soon, you will have nowhere to call home. Seated before his scales, Lord Justice Monkey IADB is eating and shouting, "Too heavy, too heavy." Do not wait until he pronounces his verdict. Well, it has been divided. Remember, when the stranger within your gates become the master of your home, your fate is doomed. Justice Monkey must be stopped. The question is, who will stop the monkey? And tonight, go ahead, Marcia. Yes,
thank you so much, Mr. Newton. And I want, before you comment any further, I want Mr. Franklin to weigh in on that and to tie it in his view to what is currently happening, because that was written back in 1997. But Mr. Franklin, you heard the story. Can you just put that in, you know, in your own interpretation as to what is happening now and relate it to Sunday? Because we only have, you know, about 10 minutes left.
Okay, we're good. Marcia, it is not even, it is an allegory, but everybody can see right through it. This is exactly what's happening. You know, this government is the Lord Justice monkey, because they are taking away our property, our rights, and giving it to their friends. This time, it is not only it isn't only cheese. It is the land, the rights that people have over land. And if we do not come out on Sunday, it will be lost to future generations. I had my time down there, and it was worthwhile. But I would like to see other people. So listen to the story. Listen to what is happening on this show, and follow this government closely, because you can't keep your eyes off them, because every time you take your eyes off them, they do something silly or something that approximate dishonesty, if not dishonesty. And we need to come out and support the people in St. Joseph, because I don't want them to take away lippies down here. Because if they get away with this, they will be emboldened, and they will get away with a lot more. Don't wait until your house is burning. You know, they say when your neighbor's house is burning, you put out the fire before it get by you. So we have to stop them in their tracks. We got to stop them. We have to let the people of Barbados know that this is a very serious issue, that we cannot afford to let this one pass. This is too basic. We have rights, and the government that should be protecting those rights are taking those rights and giving. You see what happened to Miss Ram? Because it was Miss Ram, a lot of people did not speak up. I spoke up in the Senate, and people tell me, "Oh, you representing Miss Ram?" I said, "No, I'm not representing Miss Ram. I am representing what is right." And a lot of people did not speak out, because it was Miss Ram, and Miss Ram has her issues. But even if you are the devil himself, and you are right.
Yes.
But the people look at her and say, "Well, oh, just Miss Ram." But now it's happening to people that look like me and you. You're going to wait till it become you? You got to get up, and we got to start working. And we got to start telling this government in no uncertain terms, thus far or no further, we know that you were pretending to care. Words from your mouth, not mine. I'm only repeating them. Marcia, don't forget your song tonight, though.
No, I don't forget
this
song tonight.
You know, and so, people of this country, open your eyes. They might be wide shut. Open them. And see, because we got a lot of people, a lot of Barbados Labour Party people, who approach me and tell me foolishness, and tell me I don't like the government. I love all of them, sorry, but the exception of one of them, and that's not Miss Motley. I like her, but I do not like the nonsense that she is doing in this country, and I must be able to say so. And if enough of you say so, she can't victimize all of you, or this government cannot victimize all of you. So stand up. But I'll finally tell you, sometimes I do some classes with industrial relations, and I walk into the classroom, I take out a box of matches, and I say to the fellow up front, break that. And everybody in the room starts looking at me like a fool. I said, "No, break that." And the guy just takes a match and he breaks it. Then I give them two, I say, "Break that." He break them. Then he take out a whole handful and they put them together and said, "No, break them." And he's still trying to get the whole handful of broken. I said, "That's your first lesson in industrial relations. They can't break you if you are together."
Yes. Yes. That's wonderful. I see Miss McLean. I think she's still on as we get ready to close. I know she's on. Miss McLean?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. Yep. I'm seeing you now. Yes.
Yes.
Any thoughts to the people of Barbados? Read this.
I was listening to Nigel, and I want to say this. I had heard that story before, and I'm going to make a comment which some people might remember. You know, you used to hear stories, and you used to say at the end, a step on the wire, and the wire won't bend.
Yes,
but for
right.
me, this story must have another end. And that end is that the people have to demand that they hold on to their cheese, onto our patrimony. Government's actions must reflect, as a primary consideration, the interests, the rights, the needs of Barbadians. And I am calling now, not only Prime Minister Barbados, who is quoted at every turn by every minister, but on what I call the silent ones, the other members of cabinet, because for some reason they don't seem to speak unless they refer to the wishes of the Prime Minister. But I think that listening to the concerns of people, we need to hear from those members of Parliament who not only have been elected as representative of constituencies, but have been named to the cabinet, to the executive of this government, who sit and agree to, whether in silence or after discussion, on matters that impact on Barbadians, and the Georges River is one of them. If they did not know about it before, they know about it now, and we need to hear their position.
Yes. And I want to say, thank you, Ms. McLean, very well said, that only today, Mr. Franklin, I saw in the newspaper, we won't deal with it now, but we will bring it up, God willing, on Monday when we have our show. But where the developers of the Pierhead development on Thursday, they are now reconsidering, they're reconfiguring this project and talking about, you know, people and involving people and the fishermen and the boats and you know, and all these things all of a sudden. And this is why I say to Barbadians, those of you who say, oh, but why do you all, you know, you keep making noise? Is it doing anything? Yes, it is. Yes, it's doing something. Yes, it's doing something. And we can see even from this, they know that Barbadians are now educated and are on to what they're doing. Because with the Spearhead project, you know what they had said? I saw in the newspaper that one of the developers said this would be the ones down in St. James. What's the name? That luxury place in St. James, Mr. Franklin. Lime Grove. That this would be like Lime Grove on steroids, right? It would be like Lime Grove on steroids. That is what they're saying. But now they're changing that. And so we continue to agitate, we continue to educate our people, and we continue to mobilize, because they are listening, they know we exist, and we will continue to do that. So Sunday is a big day for us, Mr. Franklin, and it looks like, you know, you might, I saw that they're preparing a shirt for you to have. For Sunday, and we have a bus that is leaving Freedom Park at 1 o'clock, and we'll get down to Bathsheba. So if you don't have a car, you said, listen, I don't have a ride, there will be a bus, so you have Freedom Park. So get to Freedom Park, bring a donation, okay, and so we can take care of the bus and all the other expenses that we have. All right, as usual, people, you know, you normally bring donations, and that help us, you know, with this motorcade protest and cookout. But it also helps, as we had some left over, we had some balance left over from the last event that we had, that was able to help us to pay for the permit today. Okay, but we do have some more expenses, so Mr. Franklin. I will give you the final word as we're closing off tonight. Okay, you are okay.
Come out.
Yes? Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, my final word is going to be very simple. Barbados needs you at Georges River on Sunday. Come out and let your presence speak to the government. Let the government know it is. This is not only a St. Joseph issue. This is a Barbados issue. We need you. You need you. The people of Barbados need you. Or you will not recognize Barbados. And when they put up the roadblocks and say you can't go down Bashiba, then you will find out why you can't go down there, because we sold, the government would have sold it off or given it away to people who don't look like us or don't even come from the Caribbean, far less looking like us. We need to stop them. And the only way we can stop them is for the people to see that that type of development is not welcomed in Barbados. It is not welcome in Bashiba. It's not welcome anywhere, because Barbados is for Barbadians first. And they don't care what they're going to bring. If they're going to take away our rights, if they're going to take away our standards, our standard of living, and push us out from the sea, because what they want the people to do is to stop going down by the sea altogether, you know. That is why you want them to jump off a cliff. And you know you're not going to jump off the cliff. So they don't want you down there, period. And they make it difficult for you to go. Trust me, I had my time down there. I enjoyed it. I want other people to enjoy it. And the only way other people after us will enjoy it is if we stand up now. Because yeah. Once that is shut off from us, it will always be shut off from us. We will never see it again.
Yeah.
You know, it is like the land. When you sell the land, it don't come back. It goes off. Look, the land that drops, all the government trying to take away now. You know how long ago that was in Drax family? From slavery days. And then he said he ain't selling it. So the government said they can take away some. Mind you, the government got a lot of land that they can use for housing, but they want to make a point. They want to show people that I don't know what they want to show people, but they're just bullies.
Yeah.
So okay. Please, come out, support yourselves, support us. I'm looking forward to seeing you on Sunday.
Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Newton, because of time and the way tonight went, we could not go any further. But thank you, Ms. McLean, who pushed through with all your technical issues to be on. And, of course, we thank Senator Watson. We thank you, Mr. Franklin and Dave, for his technical services. And to everybody who joined tonight, thank you. And I'm looking forward to seeing you at Bathsheba. We're looking forward to see you right there at St. Elizabeth Primary. Don't let it be just myself and Caswell down there. You know, Mr. Newton, come on, everybody. Let's come out and make this a real family affair, because indeed we're a family. So see you at Joe's River Motorcade and Cookout on Sunday, April 7th at 2 p.m. All right? Okay.
If you are snort English.
If you really want to thank me,
that math, nor English. Pretending to be good. Pretending to be good. Just pretending to be good. Pretending to be good. Just pretending to care about people. 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 Pretending. And I'm pretending to be good at math, nor English. Just pretending to care about people. And I'm pretending to be good at math nor English. I just pretending to care about people. I'm pretending to be good. And I'm pretending to be good at math nor English. I just pretending to care about people. And I'm pretending to be good at math nor English. I just pretending to care about people.
All right, you folks, see you all. We're going to play it live. We're going to play it live on Sunday. So see you all. God bless you.
We love you all. Bye-bye.
Good night.